Good evening, Dude79 here. Just doing a quick mic check to make sure we don't have the fucking robot voice going on. So hopefully everything sounds good.
Hey, how's it sound? Hi.
Hi.
I sound like a robot voice.
We'll be live in just a moment. Welcome to another edition of Banter and Babble. I'm the Dude79, and joining me always, my esteemed colleague and renowned piece of shit, Mr. Fanboytone. Hey, Fanboytone. Okay, hey. Nobody cares. But joining us tonight, once again, the man, the myth, the Mocha-Skinned MANimal himself, Mr. Rohit Raju.
That's right. Talking on the mic, saber crushing fools like Darth Vader, the Mocha-Skinned MANimal himself. Rohizis peace. Rohizi ravishing Rohit Raju here to bitch about some stuff. Well, no, I'm just
saying. A little bit.
Not really, but we're going to have a good time.
How's it going, buddy? Welcome back.
I love coming to talk shop with you guys. I absolutely love it.
We have a lot of shop to talk about. We got a lot of good stuff to talk about tonight.
Sweet.
But first and foremost, man, nobody cares what we've been up to. We want to know, what have you been up to?
Yeah. Life, trying to enjoy each and every second of it. Been going down to Orlando, and I had a busy weekend last weekend. I was in Orlando, then St. Louis, and drove back with the Michigan crew back up to Michigan. A lot of wrestling. I'll be in Chicago with Karam on the 14th at Freelance, and then the 30th back in St. Louis. Jorah and myself, our match should be airing on AEW Dark, I believe, next week. So if you pay attention to my Instagram, RajuZane80, or my Twitter, Hakim Zane, that's H-A-K-I-M, you'll see that. Hopefully they air the promo we cut, because that's like my bread and butter.
Oh, yeah,
and he's getting good at it, too. He's probably getting some confidence with that. So, but yeah, on AEW Dark, you'll see us kicking some butt. So other than that, that's it, man.
Down in Florida, enjoying that warm weather.
Oh, my God. I go down there, and it is amazing. It was 90 degrees the past couple times I went down there, but it was a breeze, so it was perfect. And it was just like, I went down there, I'm like, man, each time I'm like, I don't know if I want to go back. Every single time.
At
so
least you brought some of the warm weather back today.
Yeah,
we had some nice weather
it
today.
Was. It was like weird storms and all that jazz, but it was
warm
out.
Hey, man, if it's 70 degrees, I don't give a fuck what it's doing outside, rain or whatnot. As long as it's not snowing and it ain't cold,
right?
I'm cool with it, man. I walked around my lunch today, even though that was a mistake because of the shorts I was wearing. When it rains in Michigan and it's even remotely warm, the humidity gets up quick. I went for a walk, dude. I had that swamp ass through my shorts and everything. I got back in the office.
Called Dagobah ass.
It was really, really bad. But
homelessness.
It was really nice being on that one more. And it's supposed to be 70s all next week. Did you see that? All next week, 70s.
Probably want to see it.
It's supposed to be toasty warm here in Michigan, dude.
I believe that. Love it when I see it.
He believes it when he sees it. Kettle says, AEW Dark, get this man on the main event.
Yeah, we're trying. Jeez,
Give me a contract.
Give him a fucking contract,
I'm
TK.
Teaming with a signed guy.
The promos alone is all you need.
No contract. Whatever, man.
The promos is all you need to see, man. I mean, we already know on the TV you're doing work. But the promos.
Yeah, thank you.
That's where they're hot.
I honestly, and I'm not even going to, in the words of Arn Anderson, I don't mean to toot my own horn, but toot, toot. My promos are really good, and they kill a lot of people that are on TV making six figures. So, I don't know. What can you do?
He's doing something right. The only people that aren't doing something right yet is AEW. Come on. Get this guy a contract. Get him on. Cuddles says, hey, man, how much you want, I can give you a contract for CWF.
Oh, yeah, CWF.
You give $5, maybe?
Jeez, at least.
We'll talk about that behind the scenes. That's a behind-the-scenes thing.
Crash want to know about his merch. You can go to prowrestlingtees.com/, I believe, Rohit Raju.
Yeah. Prowrestlingtees.com. Oh, I'm sorry. Prowrestlingtees.com/Rohit.
Rohit, there you go. Yo, it'll get you there. First start with Google. That's a good spot.
I do have a question for you guys out there. This shirt is probably my best-selling shirt. I used to go by the name Hakim Zane until when I was in Impact, they changed it, that Wu-Tang design. I have a design, but my art skills are not what they used to be. I'm thinking of two R's, but the same style, and then it just says Rohit right in the middle. I tried to draw it, and it didn't turn out that well. So anyone that's good at art, even if it's just it's a simple design, let me know how much you want for it. I've asked some people, they're like, $200. I'm like, man, it's a simple design. Yeah. And it's two colors. There's no way I'm paying you $200 for that. I think that cost me like $50.
Right.
And I've sold that, but I don't wrestle under Hakim Zane anymore. So I'd like to get the double
crazy that this one sells. It's because of the Wu-Tang probably partly.
It's the Wu. Yeah, that's how like any type of... Like if you have a familiar look to it,
right,
then people are going to jump on it.
Well,
like a lot of people, you'll see they'll have like Spider-Man covers or Zelda or something like that, but it'll have their name and they're like, oh, that looks like this, and then they'll buy it. So.
Right, right. Well, two, that I think, you're known at least in early indies as Hakim Zane.
Yes.
And, it's funny because last fall, I'm in Pinconning at a random ass fucking diner in Pinconning.
Oh, yeah, you're telling me.
And
that.
I text you, I'm like, bro, I was in here eating my food, and some old dude and his lady was like, hey, hey. I'm looking over, and they're like, of course, he used to go by Mad Dragon originally as well, too. Yeah. Hakim Zane Mad Dragon. And they're like, you know Mad Dragon? Hakim Zane? I'm like, yeah. Like, that's sweet. This is really random. I'm in a random ass fucking diner, and, 40 minutes, an hour from here, and I'm wearing this fucking shirt, and I'm getting pointed at about it.
That makes me feel
that
good.
That's funny.
I remember one time I walked into Meyer. It was late at night. It was after the gym. And some guy goes, "Hey, Rohit." And I was like, "Yeah?" And he's like, "You still wrestling on Impact?" And I was like, "No, I'm not there anymore." He goes, "Oh, can I get a picture?" And I was like, "Sure." And I'm like, that's so weird. Mm-hmm. But it was cool. You know what I mean?
That people recognize, man. They understand. They recognize the talent. They recognize the skills. And it's just a matter of time. So, I mean, just keep crushing on EW Dark. Show people what you can do. Not only up on the stage, but, you know, on those promos, man.
Yeah. And come on, Ring of Honor. You can't spell Rohit without the letters ROH.
You really can't.
It writes itself. I'm like just walking bag of money, just sitting here on the table, and nobody's
true.
Nobody's
he's a bag of
it.
Money. We're bags of milk. I mean, yeah. that's how it works.
Bags
I dig
of
it.
Bags of milk. Bags of fucking milk.
That's yeah, right. it's depressing. I won't lie. It hurts. It hurts. It hurts. Especially when I see people that like I was in the ring with at one point in time. They're like getting paid all this money. I'm like, I can't be doing that. But it's just like, it hasn't been in the cards yet. So it's like, damn, it sucks. But what can you do? I mean, I try to take away the positives of it that I've had a really good career in wrestling. I've met some awesome people that I've watched on TV when I was young and mm-hmm. have them in my phone. You know what I mean? I can call them and talk to them for advice and stuff. So that's really cool. But I'm always a hungry individual and I'm always driven. So when I love something and it's there for the taking, I want to go after it. And so it almost gets unhealthy to where it becomes an obsession. So like when something happens, it knocks me back a few pegs and sure. it sucks. You know how it is.
Yeah,
like,
oh yeah.
Like you're very passionate about something and you're just like, God, why can't I be in that spot?
I want to be a Vegas dancer for years.
There you go. I mean, you can still do it. Are you kidding me? I think you can still do
Thank
it.
Thank you.
But yeah, but other than that, man, I always appreciate you guys' support and yeah. you guys always I just yeah. like that. Thank
and
you.
See, man, I just
Thank
tell
you guys too. I appreciate it.
I know you mentioned yeah. sometimes it gets tough, but I mean the thing that I respect the most about you, man, is it doesn't convey through that that's going on. I mean, it's always just 110% no matter what you're doing. And your love and passion for it is what really, you know, brings me in that I really appreciate and respect. So, I mean, continue to do your thing. Mm-hmm. And like you said, man, there's a plan in place.
Hope so.
By the powers that be. And at some point, it's going to pay off. But, I mean, in the meantime, just keep fucking crushing it, man. I mean, it's really top tier
shit. I like when you and that's, you know, what is it? Art imitates life is when you let it bleed into your promos. I mean, because yes. I've known you for so long, like, I can hear the frustration come out in your promos. And I don't think everybody always catches that. Maybe some folks do. But, like, you use that as a platform from some of your promos. And that's fucking gnarly to me, too, because I'm like,
Because that's real and it's genuine.
Yeah, because, it's real. Yeah. Absolutely.
And instead of me, and the way I would talk about it here in a promo, I'd be like, and you got this guy right here. He's not even as good as me, and he's making six figures. He has great credit. Meanwhile, I'm struggling in the dirt, in the grime, and for years, but I'm better, you know, and then it starts, it's just real. Yeah. But then you just say it as Rohit, and you can get away with things when you get to say it as a promo.
Maybe you should start saying that you're the grandson of a plumber.
Yeah, Daddy, let me tell you something right here.
There you go.
We was talking about it with Silvertongue, Tony Schiavone, and I. That's right. We're going to talk about a little WrestleMania, make a nightmare. He ain't the making dream, no, Daddy. Ain't too many years.
Josie Wells asks, what wrestler made you feel the most awe? Like, I can't believe I'm wrestling this dude. Or somebody that you were just, like, really hyped to go up against.
I can't think of it, and it's bothering me. The latest would have been Rocky Romero or Christopher Daniels.
That was a big one for me when you fucking wrestled the fucking Fallen Angel.
Yeah, and Ring of Honor, and their first, and it was a big deal, and especially a big deal wrestling with him, and he was so fun to work with, and he was easy.
Was he?
And I knew I did well with him out there, so that made me feel good.
Dude.
Rocky, same way. Rocky's a lot of people don't know Rocky. Rocky Romero's a legend. He is in charge of a lot of stuff at New Japan right now, and I got to work with him twice, and there was a thing called New Japan Strong, where it was kind of like a New Japan Indie. And I know my name was getting thrown around for that, and it kind of they're not doing it right now, so that didn't happen. But I can't remember, but there are people out there. I'd have to see it, but there's a lot of guys. Like, when I first wrestled Rhino, that was a huge thing for me.
Oh, yeah.
Getting the chance to, like, wrestle Sabu, Tommy Dreamer, TJP. TJ was, like, a guy that I watched forever, and he was huge in WWE.
He's like 150 years old. Looks like he's 20.
Wrestles like he's 20. He's probably one of the best wrestlers that doesn't get any credit. Absolutely love the guy. And he's a big Star Wars fan. And he's a big fan of mine, which makes me feel tremendous. And he's also a huge help. He helped me find a lot of confidence and feel like I can wrestle anybody.
Awesome.
Especially with my X Division run. TJ was a huge help. And I owe him a lot. But there's a few people, and I can't think of it. Steiner Brothers were really cool when I got a chance to be in the ring with them. But I can't. There's a ton of guys that just like I have action figures in my garage of these guys, and just being able to be in the ring with them or just talk to them and shoot the shit with them or pick their brain has been right. really cool. And it's something I never thought I would do. And wrestling is has taken me to some really cool places, and I've met some very wonderful people, and I do appreciate it. But as always, I want more because I just, you know, I love wrestling and I know how good I am. Mm-hmm. And it's just, it hasn't been in the cards for me. So, which is always disappointing, but you know, it is what it is. I do appreciate it. And mm-hmm. the fact that I've done it for as long as I have is pretty cool. And I've been, knock on wood, I've been lucky. So,
mm-hmm. you know, you mentioned all those big names that you've gone up against. Still, my favorite match I think I've seen of yours is when we were in Bay City and you and Jake
yes.
went toe to toe. Remember when we went to that match right before COVID hit? And I just remember, I mean, there was a lot of people that were there. There was a lot of good wrestlers, local and guys on your level. But I mean, when you and Jake got up there, that was, for me, my money, I was like, this is the most entertaining match by far.
When you have that ring chemistry, as long as you guys been wrestling each other, know each other so well, you know, again, the Vegeta and the Goku you know, like it's different because it's a whole other thing that's going on just because you guys know what you're going to do next. It's like you guys can like almost, you know, no finish like your sentences and stuff like that too. Yeah. And it makes those matches so much crazier to watch because mm-hmm. of that.
That's another guy too, and I don't want to take too much time on it, but like he's another guy. If you guys ever seen Jake something, he's one of my good friends. But when you see me, I'm if I'm just walking down the street, you're like, oh, okay, that guy looks like he's kind of built, you know, he's short, whatever. But if you see me, once you see me walk through the curtain and I do my thing, you're like, oh my God, this guy belongs out there. If you see Jake anywhere, you're like, that guy does something.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? Because he's huge. He's like 6'2", 200.
You bit there about something?
I didn't actually. I didn't mean to do a bit. But that guy is someone.
Right.
But like, because he looks, he's like a walking door, you know, a walking refrigerator. He's a giant of a man. And the cool thing is Jake can wrestle anybody. He can wrestle a big man style. He can wrestle light against lightweight mm-hmm. guys. He can do it all. And he can cut good promos now. And he just has that it factor. Like I said, when he walks out in public, people instantly notice him, want to talk to him, and flock to him. So, yeah, Matt Cardona was really sweet. I enjoyed working with him and cutting promos on him. But, yeah, I mean, that's another guy. I don't know how he hasn't been signed somewhere and scooped up. It's wrestling's weird.
It is weird. It's really weird.
And I'm not great at social media. I don't like to get on social media a lot. Like, I just did a Patreon, and a lot of it's, like, stuff for me going to the gym. And I need to do more on my Patreon. I've been slacking. But, but like, people really get flashy moves, going viral and stuff like that really gets you attention now.
It does.
It's
man.
Like, and I don't have the time or desire to be posting on social media all day.
That's the hardest thing, man. Mm-hmm. That's the hardest thing, seriously, is your socials and trying to be consistent.
You guys get it.
I mean, I get it as like, I understand it's a commitment, but like, even then, it's just like, man, I can't do it as much as I know as I should be doing it
right.
in order for it to like really grow. But like, I try to do bits and pieces here and there, grab segments or do things like that. But the level of commitment, like when we talk to Boots, like we know her commitment to it. Like, she does a lot of stuff socially, and it's just like, man, she has to be so exhausted because she has a life outside of that. Right. And she's still balancing that. It's just like, it is, man. It's a fucking commitment.
Danhausen and Ethan Page are two guys that have mastered social media and have blown up, mm-hmm. not only because of their ring work and their promos, but they've blown up because they've mastered social media. Ethan Page was the first guy doing vlogs, backstage vlogs, all that stuff, and he doesn't need to do that anymore. But a lot of that, because everyone wants to peek behind the curtain, and he gave everybody that small peek behind the curtain. Mm-hmm. And I'll never forget, we did the Fat Food Fest. We were in St. Louis, and we ate a whole bunch of Arby's, we ate donuts, we had shakes, we had pizza, we had all this in one night after a show, and it was, the views were like millions of views.
It's like his either second, I think it's his top three, I think, most views, I think, still.
Yeah, and it was just a bunch of us, and we had so much fun doing it, and I ate so much food, I thought I was going to puke. But it was such a good time, and when we were in Impact together, we would do the lifting videos all the time. And I would get a lot of GIFs. Fans would make GIFs off of me just from that stuff. Like,
right.
They would quote things I would say. Like, there's one GIF I started using. I'll say, spoilers, because I was talking about The Mandalorian. And they're like, oh, don't say nothing. And someone I thought it was really cool. But, man, social media is key. And a lot of people, like, I see a lot of, and to each their own, but they sell their bodies. A lot of, I'm huge into fitness, so I see a lot of women. They look great, mm-hmm. so they sell their bodies, and they'll have millions of views and millions of followers, and they're just working out or doing very risque yoga poses and stuff like that, but they're doing it with booty shorts, and more power to them. And there's guys that do the same thing. If I had the patience and stuff like that, I would, you know, do something like that. I work out. I would, honestly, but I just don't have the patience and the want and the desire to. But, I mean, your guys, this right here is no different from anyone that's popular. You guys put a lot of effort into this. You have great production. You have a great opening. You have great music. You have great value. I mean, and you guys care about what you're doing. You have great conversations. You guys just need eyes on you, and then you just need something. You need a spark to help you blow up as well.
Absolutely.
Because you're not doing anything different than all these other guys and girls that are out there making all this money and having all these views, and that's what it sucks, because you guys just need that. The same
catching
thing.
That lightning in a bottle.
That's what you need.
Going viral or something.
And it's such a pain in the ass when you know you're doing something well and you just can't get that recognition.
Right.
And it's still fun.
Right.
And then obviously when it stops being fun, that's when we got to hang up the boots.
It's hard. And, like, you know, really at the end of the day, we all still work. You know what I mean? So you can't spend the amount of time you would like to doing this, that, and the other, being on socials as well too.
I'm sorry, it's Mountain Dew.
It's a movie magic.
Right. You know, I'm just kind of going through some of the people that there's a lot of people out there kind of agreeing about the social media and stuff like that. You know, just it's a lot of work at the end of the day. And, like, you know, you say guys like Ethan and Danhausen too. You know, the big thing I think with those two is that they're also really, which is rare. I don't think it's rare, but, like, they're extra good to their fans.
They are.
They're very thankful to their fans. They do a lot of fan-based content. They go out there and they do these cons. They do these meet and greets and stuff like that. Both of them now live in Michigan, of course. Well, you know, Dan hasn't always has, but, you know, Ethan's doing stuff all over. They're doing stuff constantly in the Midwest now, doing, like, meet and greets, toy hunts and stuff like that, and just getting people involved. So, you know, I mean, again, you know, if you've got the time to do that and able to have it, it's great. But it's a balance sometimes. But
it is.
Know, here
and
we are.
That is one thing I wish I could do. I not being an impact hurts me, because it's funny, because I can't get, like, certain indie bookings now, because that star starts to tarnish and fade a little bit. You know what I mean? Because even with Impact, didn't have, like, a whole bunch of views. Mm-hmm. It had enough views, and I was on every week. Mm-hmm. So there was always, my name was always buzzing.
Right. Yep.
AEW Dark, it gets a lot of views, but there's so many AEW fans that have no idea who AEW Dark wrestlers are that are signed to the company because they're not on TV. And so it's like, it helps and then it doesn't help. It's weird. It's all about the popularity and attention now. It sucks.
Like you said, you got to have as many eyes on as possible in order for you to, like, kind of go over and
and these
where you want to be.
Wrestling promoters or marks, doesn't matter what promotion, whether they're on TV or not. If you have the popularity, they're going to want to bring you in.
Right.
You could be, they know how good I am. One of the greatest things makes me feel good is when I go into that locker room, there's guys that are like, oh, you're not signed yet? Like AEW guys. You know what I mean? They'll be like, are you not signed yet? No. Like, why?
You tell them, hey, go talk to TK for me?
Yeah. But they don't want me eating off their plate. You know what I mean? So that's just how it is.
Yeah, well, if there's food out, you're going to be eating off their plate either
exactly.
way.
Exactly. I cut that promo.
You know? Yeah, I know.
Nom, nom, nom.
But, that's hilarious.
Which is, I thought you would get a kick out of that. But yeah, it's because it makes me, and I remember I was down, and these guys that are, these two guys are really cool. They're like, dude, we all know what you can do.
Mm-hmm.
He goes, it's not that you're not doing anything wrong. We know what you can do. Mm-hmm. He knows what you can do. Mm-hmm. It's just a matter of when they're going to pull the trigger with you. Mm-hmm. So that made me feel good. It's they know how good I am. Yeah. It's just,
that motivates you, man. It motivates you to keep stay the past.
It does. And I have fun there, and I love teaming with Jorah. I mean, yeah, if the thing is, AEW owns ROH. And I don't even have a contract for that. And I don't know. And I don't want to, it's weird. I don't want to act like I'm, because I'm not downing anybody or throwing dirt on anything.
No.
But I want to be signed.
Yeah.
I want to be signed. And I think, I don't want to say I deserve to be signed, but I'm good enough to be signed.
Yeah.
And I'm good enough to, if you give me the ball, because when Impact gave me the ball, I ran with it. And I became a namesake in that company. I became a prominent name. And that's all I need. But without that opportunity.
Right.
You know,
and let's be honest, the X Division, I'm sorry, just isn't as fun now.
I do like Trey's run, though. Trey's that heel that you want to see get beat up.
Miguel.
Yeah, and he's also phenomenal in the ring. So, but I hit back Impact. I would love to go back to Impact, too. I'm going to try to, I've been in talks with Gail, she was like, hey, you know, the roster's really bloated right now, but if you can make an appearance, you should come and show face again. So they have a show in Chicago. I don't know if I can make that. I was going to do the show in Windsor, but then I ended up getting booked for the AEW weekend. Mm-hmm. So I couldn't do Windsor, but they are in June coming to Columbus. So I'm going to try to get back to Columbus, and I'm going to pitch some ideas. Even if they don't sign me, I just want to wrestle.
Right.
So you're going to not even sign me. Just let me work and just get that relevant booking. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Even NWA on YouTube, I would love to. I want to reach out to them and try and get some work with them. I just want to work at relevant places and show, like, hey, this guy still exists and he's still really good.
Maybe try seeing and put together, you know, take some time, sit down. I mean, you're good at writing promos. Maybe you could write a song. Maybe say, hey, Billy Corgan, here, I got the song for Pumpkins.
Today was the greatest. Have you ever heard that song?
Yeah.
I just thought of it on the spot.
I've been signed now. It really took too long.
I cut good promos.
He does.
And I'm handsome, too.
And he's good looking, too. Perfect. Second best looking guy at the table, man. I dig it. All right, so we have a ton of stuff to talk about.
Yeah, we just took an hour trying to BS. Yeah. We're like, we're going to watch our time tonight. We just took a whole hour
we're
gonna BSing.
No, we do have a great show. We have a lot of stuff to talk about, some stuff that these guys really want to chime in on. I think there's going to be some good conversations towards the back end of the show. But first up, Tom, we're going to hop into a little bit of a movie review.
Yeah,
and we're going to keep it spoiler free. Keeping things spoiler-free so it doesn't ruin anything. But, Tone?
Yeah.
Going into this past weekend, you had your reservations about Dungeons & Dragons.
I also got my reservations to see the...
Yeah. You bought your tickets early. Dungeons & Dragons, Honor Among Thieves. It was mostly you had the reservations prior to when there was some bits going on.
And the original trailer dropped, and I thought the CG looked a little wonky.
Sure.
Which it didn't actually in the movie.
No, that CG actually looked pretty good. I mean, it still looks CG, but it was very detailed. It was very well done. But, you know, we had some reservations going into it, but then the reviews started coming out. We're just like, oh, this might... Mm-hmm. Now, when I see reviews for something like D&D, I take it with a grain of salt because they're there just for entertainment value. But, I mean, there are some reviewers who are D&D fans. But, ultimately, I wanted to hear from, like, you. I wanted to hear from Drastin, like, their thoughts on this movie and how it would be respectful of the source material and the game itself. And, you know, your concerns were, is it going to be too campy? Is it going to be too focused on fun? Because the trailers definitely gave off the vibe that it was going to be more of a comedy than anything else. And so we had our reservations going into it. But, Tone, after seeing this movie, it even surpassed my expectations by a wide margin. Like, it wasn't even close, dude. But I want to get your initial thoughts to this movie. I mean, Tone, going into it, you had some concerns, but after you left the theater, I think you and I were kind of like on the same page.
This is a complete surprise. Drastin said it too. Like, seeing the reviews, I thought, okay, it's gonna be a fun movie. I'll probably at least be entertained, and it won't be too, you know. And I'll still say it was good, but you know. But I honestly, like, this for me, as far as entertainment and enjoyment, this teeters pretty heavily on great. Like, I did not expect this to be such a good balance act of storytelling, good levity, good characters, and even development, and even some backstory like you'd expect. But all in all, at the end of the day, as a hardcore fan for so many years, also having a ton of nods, meta nods, that if you've played or been experienced, you wouldn't really ever get, which is fine because it doesn't matter if it goes over your head because the rest of the movie's entertaining.
Sure.
But for people like me or Drastin, like, some of the references, you're like, oh, shit. Like, for instance, him being a Harper. A Harper is a pretty massive good guy group in the Forgotten Realms setting.
Uh-huh.
You know? So, like, when he said, oh, I used to be a Harper, I was like, what the fuck? Did he say Harper out loud? Like, I never thought in my mind I would ever have that happen, right? You know? And some of the characters, some character name drops and some different things as well, too. And that happened throughout the film as well, too. But what really made this so just engaging for me, and again, this is kind of outside the fact of just trying to, you know, having the casual objective headset on with this, is that it felt like a D&D campaign.
It did.
Like, it felt like, cool. Like, there were things that they did during the movie that, you know, for instance, when you're doing, like, stat checks, like, you know, for instance, like, when you play video games, you know, that have, like, stat checks in the background, like a Dragon Age or something, like, when you're hitting something, when you're looking at the menus and you're looking at the math and you're crunching numbers, you know, your two-hit percentage is this, this, and this, or even, like, people that played Fallout, that's what D&D is. It's all numbers and blah, blah, blah. Well, you can see while you're watching this movie, there are certain points in time where you can tell, like, it was almost like three or four people just had to do rolls and try and check. Either they passed or failed or whatever it would be. And it fit into the film. And then even just the little things were like, there's different types of players that play D&D. There's always these archetypes of players as they play their characters that they kind of fall into. Some people like their RP sense. Some people have like ADHD and just want to kill shit all the time.
Right.
Some people just absentmindedly, either their character or them, don't think about something and fuck something up. Mm-hmm. And then the DM's got to switch on a dime on it. All that sort of stuff in the real life, all this meta stuff, didn't break fourth wall, mind you, and didn't feel like it was like pushed or anything like that either. It didn't feel forced. You when you're watching this, I'm like, I see that. That's pretty funny. So honestly, my only critique of it is just a really super core nerddom thing, is that when they were in the Underdark, I wanted to see, you know, either Drugar, Drow, or like Illithids or Mind Flayers. And we didn't get to see any of those. So when you say Underdark, to me, that
immediately
triggers like certain species and people and things I want to see because I'm such a super fan. Exactly. Grevin knows. No drits. Pass. You know, things in that nature. They did make a mention of Elminster, though, which was pretty fucking dope. But I mean, I don't know exactly where they were at in the map area, but you know, when you're a Harper, that's typically in the Dale area, so it would make sense they would use the name Elminster. But yeah, I definitely wanted some of those things. But honestly, like, Michelle Rodriguez playing like a barbarian, like, that was great.
She was really good.
Her background story was like very subtle, but like to the point. It wasn't like too much, didn't drown out from the main story.
Yep.
Like every character had this background story or this little something going on.
Some of you could sympathize with, like, a lot of people.
Right.
There's a lot of relatable stuff going on.
What was her name? The druid, the tiefling druid, Druick, or whatever her name was.
Yeah, the girl from It. That was Beverly.
Yeah, she. Relax. So she, you know, she doesn't, you don't dive too deep into her background, but she does briefly talk about it, gets to the point, makes it why she's driven to do what she's doing, why she's teaming up.
Yep.
Honestly, there's a lot of movies that I feel like could sit down and go, oh man, they know how to character drive in a 2.5-hour movie.
Yeah.
Maybe we could learn something. And it's because I'm guessing, and I don't know, but the people that wrote this movie are D&D players.
Oh, yeah.
And if you want people out there, movies, TV series, who you need to lean in are not people with big last names that have been around forever.
Yeah.
Maybe you should lean into people that are big super fans, and we'll talk more into this later. I know I can see it on your face already. Maybe you should lean into your fandom or the people that are really passionate about it, because sometimes they're the ones that are probably going to actually drive your product better than you can.
Right.
And you want to make some money, lean into your fans a little bit.
Yeah.
Right? You know what I mean? And that's just it. Like, guys like Drastin work hard on a Sunday morning or afternoon for 4 hours putting together his campaign for Monday.
Yep.
You know, sitting there making notes, doing all this stuff, and weaving these crazy tales and stories, spinning the yarn, as we say, and then, you know, double check with me if it's okay or good or not. You know, but that's the point. Like, these guys are the guys you want writing stories. These guys work hard to write good stories, and you know, that's where we're at with this. And you know, it's done well overall, and I really feel like if you're not a D&D player, if you are, whoever you are, if you're a fan of all things entertainment, enjoyable, whether that's, you know, levity, good character development, adventure, you like medieval, it hits a lot of marks. I tell everybody at this point, you need to go see it, because if anything, you'll come out surprised. You might not love it like some of us will, but you're probably gonna go, that, you know what, that was a good fun movie.
Yeah.
You could waste your $11 on a lot of other things somewhere else in life.
Yeah.
You know, and you wouldn't do it here, I don't feel.
I mean, awesome. Like you mentioned, it has so many, it ticks off so many boxes on the list of like a good a fantasy adventure. Like you said, the levity's there. You've got the sense of urgency in many situations. There's some heartfelt moments involving some of the characters and some of the decisions that people have to make.
Yeah.
I mean, it has a lot for everybody. It has a wide range of emotions that you can experience at the movie. And, you know, 2 hours, 15 minutes, whatever it was super, like, just entertaining. Like, it was just, I was always engaged. I loved all the characters. I mean, Hugh Grant is in it for a little bit, but I mean, he's great.
Slime bag.
He's a scumbag in the movie. He's really
That's
good.
Awesome. Yeah.
There's a fucking hilarious cameo about midway through that I didn't realize who it was until I looked closer. I was like, wait a minute, is that? And I was like, oh my God, okay.
I'm trying to think. There's been some other cameos in movies in the last couple years that I think we were caught off guard by that.
Yeah. This one was unexpected.
This was another one of those, like, what? Like, really random.
Very random.
And almost to the point where you could tell it was almost like him literally as a player playing the character, which again, in that kind of behind, oh, that almost meta sense made it even more entertaining because he was being a little bit extra, but he's also being the character. So it was just, it was a brilliant cameo. It was absolutely
amazing. There's a lot of things in this movie that, and I could, watching the movie, it reminded me of the one shot we did with Dresden. I mean, like, there's so much in this movie that seemed like an experience that I played in the one shot. Like I said, it was fun. It was funny. There's some really intense moments when we got down to battling where we had to work together and look at our options and abilities and how we could utilize or coordinate that together, the synergy and everything. And I felt like that was really implemented well in the movie.
It was conveyed really well,
And the other thing that I really liked is there's a scene where it's in the trailer where they're about to cross a bridge. Hamsters. And the guy that's explaining the mechanism on the bridge, the puzzle, is just like this deep, intricate puzzle that has to be solved. He's like, you got to walk on the odd numbers first, and the second half you got to do even numbers. And all I could imagine was like, this is probably what Dresden is like as a DM sometimes when he gets really nasty for it with his players. Like, put something that's just so absurd in front of him, be like, good luck. And like, even the actors in the movies, when he's going over all these like different things they got to figure out to do, being like, Jesus, like, really? Are we really going to have to go there? Like you can imagine in a D&D session when he get into some of those deeper, like more intricate plots that Dresden cooks up, where everyone's just kind of like, what do we got to do? Like, we got to do all this? And I mean, they really do address that. And that was just so fucking cool how they had those little things in there. But I mean, there's a lot of name drops, location name drops, characters and stuff like that. Even some of the stuff that I'm not familiar with that you were bringing up, I'm like, man, I missed a lot of things. Didn't miss it, but just didn't really catch on to it. Mm-hmm. But they just did a great job. Like, it's a fucking entertaining movie. My kids loved it. And I was just like, as soon as I walked out of the theater, I was like, man, this needs to be a trilogy. Like, they really could dive into this with these characters, with this type of writing and storytelling, and make it an entertaining trilogy or something like that.
Yeah, I'm hoping that it continues to do as well as it has, and that maybe we can get more because, like something similar to like Lord of the Rings, this is the other type of fantasy that exists out there. Okay, I thought it was going to be something completely else. I thought because I said Lord of the Rings, I just triggered you. I'm like, oh shit, he's gonna. Yeah, exactly. there's just a lot of lore to pick from, and they literally, I mean, they didn't even scratch the surface on 2-3% of the lore in this campaign setting. I mean, the Forgotten Realms campaign setting has been around since like the late 80s.
Right.
You know what I mean? Characters, locations, backstories. I mean, I'm talking like insane shit, like novel series that I still pay attention to that have been going on since the early 90s that have 30 or 40 books, you know what I mean? Like, there's just so much that they can do and go on here, and it's crazy. But
hopefully, go ahead.
No, you please go ahead.
Hopefully, if it gets a trilogy, that they remember what brought them to the dance, you know what I mean? Because sometimes they're like, oh,
bigger
now.
And better.
Yeah, and then they forget. The studios start to input, and then it gets ruined.
Well, Hasbro, let's start there. Hasbro owns the parent company, so let's start there.
Okay.
So that's scary. I want to go down. I did see some stuff. People are talking about, there's a lot of good movies. Yeah, movies are coming out too fast right now. So much good stuff coming out.
We were talking about that before the show. Yeah. Like, this movie made $70 million its first weekend, and $150 million to make it. Now, obviously, word of mouth is really picking up. I mean, it reviewed well, the critic score and the audience score, but I mean, you got Mario this weekend.
Yep.
You still got John Wick out there. You got Air this weekend. Renfield next weekend. Evil Dead Rises the weekend after. Mm. It's going to be difficult for this movie to maintain that, to keep that momentum going. And I hope that doesn't hurt it too much to where they don't get all that money back. But we talked about also
streaming.
If it gets out to streaming services, because movies are coming out at a much quicker rate now when it comes to streaming. Like Scream 6 comes out at the end of this month.
That's weird.
So, I mean, we're no longer at the 6-month turnaround like we did growing up. It's like some movies are like 2 weeks.
Well, I think blockbusters, I think Spider-Man No Way Home took a while to come out in digital.
Uh-huh.
And then
Disney
Avatar,
is still in different.
Avatar is still not out yet.
Avatar is out now.
Oh, is it out?
It just
came
out last week.
Okay.
Oh, shit. Did it?
Wow.
Okay, yep. Well, so, I mean, it just really depends. I know. I think it is. God, what one? There's one studio that's like 2 weeks. I know it's not Paramount.
It's Universal or something, isn't it?
It's somebody big. Wow, cause like a movie. What was the one I showed you and I and Prime were talking about? I saw a picture of
Creed 3.
Creed. Creed's already out.
Yeah.
That's been out for like 3 weeks.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that some of these movies are coming out like really fast. Paramount, I think Paramount is the only one that kind of looks at how it's doing in the theater itself. Where Creed is did well. I mean, it did good.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But they have like a set thing, like 3 weeks, and we're punching that thing out. Paramount kind of moves around, and I know Universal is kind of, I think they're like 30 days.
Gotcha.
So, I mean, I really do hope that they that this movie can do well in the theaters, because as you can make, and it's a movie we're seeing in theaters. But like we mentioned, you know, when it hits streaming, that's where it can recoup a lot of its cost.
Right. And Hasbro, like, they're going to be looking at all the other stuff, too. The figures, the toys, merchandising, and stuff like that, too. Yeah. They'll get their fucking money, that's for sure. but we made them bend the knee this year. That's the big piece of
it,
there you go.
Knock at the Cabin. That's another one that came out relatively that one quick. Too. I mean, that came out a month after.
But see, I heard that was really good, right?
I thought it was okay.
It was good.
It wasn't peak Shyamalan, but it was decent.
I don't think the peak Shyamalan's been on. I don't think he's had that.
It's
for
hit
a
or
while,
miss.
Right?
Well, apparently the TV series that he won't shut up about is really good on Apple TV.
It did not stick the landing.
Oh no!
Not terrible.
What is it called?
The Servant. But I mean, like up until the finale, like especially like, the last three episodes leading up to the finale, it had gotten really good, like really leaning into Rosemary's Baby vibes.
Oh, okay.
And then when it got to the final episode, we were waiting for the big like Shyamalan twist, and it was there, but it was just kind of like, But I mean, I respect the fact that
dead.
I do respect the fact that one thing that he did is that was originally supposed to be a 6-season run.
Yeah.
But after the first 2 seasons, he was like, we're going to dial back to 4. He didn't want to like overstay its welcome. And
that's
knowing what the finale was, I'm glad it didn't go 6 more or 2 more seasons just to reach that point. So, I mean, it could have been worse if they dragged it out more for that finale. But it wasn't terrible. But it wasn't the best stuff, the best ending I was hoping to get. So
Okay.
But no, I think this movie's awesome. I think it's worth seeing in the theater. You have to see it, and if not, if it comes to digital, you got to check it out. It is a fucking entertaining movie.
See, stuff like that needs the. I think they're going to get my money, so I want to support stuff like that.
Yeah, and it's not their action figures. So Peak Shyamalan, you mean 1999? Exactly. Yeah, I mean,
I don't know, man. I think
he's had some all right. Come on,
Split was
good.
Awesome.
Yeah, Split was good.
Not the follow up.
He drops the ball.
Yeah, that was really bad. What was it called, the last one?
Glass,
yeah. That wasn't good. He had the one, The Visitor, I think it was, or Visiting, or The Visitor. That was really good. That was like a smaller film that came out just before Split, I think. And I was like, oh, fuck, man, this movie's really good. So, I mean, he's got The Visit. There you go. Yeah, there's a couple in there, but, yeah, it's been a while since we've had, like, I think Split's probably his last epic, like, holy shit movie with an awesome, like, ending.
McAvoy carried the fuck out of that, but...
Yeah, my favorite is Lady in the Water. That's the one with Paul Giamatti, I believe.
That's a Split movie, too. Half people
that's
like that.
That's the one that's...
Like...
Yeah, that's much like The Village. Like, either some people really
I don't mind
some
The Village.
People don't.
I don't really like The Village.
It's not a great movie. I didn't mind it. For some reason, I was surprised by the twist.
Oh! Really? I think that was one of them. I was like, oh, okay.
Yeah, that's about it. Yeah. Didn't they have Hurt in it? William Hurt?
I think so.
Yes.
At first, I was thinking of The Happening. That was with Marky Mark, right? The trees are talking.
Oh, The Happening.
Yeah. What's up? You're a goat. That's great. Maybe we could do a movie together. Yeah. Have your people call my people. Yeah. Say hello to your mother for
Say
me.
Say hello to your mother for me.
Yeah. No, in the fucking house.
We want to get you guys and girls' thoughts. If you checked out Dungeons and Dragons, Honor Among Thieves, let us know in the comments. If you're watching on YouTube or if you're listening on Spotify or iTunes, sound off in the comments. Let us know what you thought of D&D Honor Among Thieves.
Stands for Dungeons and Dragons.
It does.
Dungeons and Dragons.
D&D.
Roll Initiative.
Very, very good movie. Hope you guys and girls enjoy it. Tone?
Yes.
We got to move on to the next topic.
Do we?
This is one where we kind of get to dive into Rohit's expertise
of the Mocha-Skinned MANimal. Yeah. Muscles are already popping, vascularity.
Oh,
look at
shirt
that.
And everything.
Yeah. God, can you dig it? Yeah.
I can dig
We're talking wrestling. All right.
WrestleMania 39. And by all accounts, leading up to the final match was a very successful WrestleMania. A lot of people talking about it. There was a lot of buzz on social media. There was a lot of buzz everywhere about the matches leading up to that final one.
Yeah.
And Tone, I wanted just before we get to the final one, before we talk about the swerve, standout matches that you saw earlier in the weekend.
Definitely Rhea Ripley versus Charlotte Flair was probably,
shocking, I would say, that was your choice.
Debatably, because Rhea's bae. Debatably the best match that weekend, or at least one of my favorites. Yeah, it was a really good match, though.
Yeah, those ladies can go.
A lot of people agree, like, that, like, after the match is done, like Charlotte put Rhea over, and she has the SmackDown title, and Charlotte was actually, like, smiling and happy because she knew that they just fucking tore the roof down. And they did. It was an absolutely amazing match. Like, just a great match. Sami Zayn and KO. I'm a KO guy. I love KO. He's just somebody I feel like I'd hang out with and punch things and drink beer, right? That match is great. Those two, Sami Zayn, they're both very talented and they're longtime friends. The Usos are. It's funny because KO said it in the after. He's like, I just got to say this. He's like, the Usos aren't underappreciated, but they're very underappreciated in how amazing they are.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And
he's
absolutely correct. Like, that their dynamic. I mean, the brothers have been wrestling together. They, you know, that's, they grew up around it. You know, just the entire match was just phenomenal. It was absolutely mad. Yeah. Honestly, Seth Rollins is always going to be entertaining.
Naturally good.
It's
man.
Weird. Like, Trick, yeah. Trick and I talk about that. Logan is. So it was a good match.
Yeah.
It was a good match. It was a very good match. They did a great job as well too. Logan Paul is such a weird anomaly of somebody who's been doing it for a year and a half, but looks like he's been doing it. Yeah. It's like he's been doing it all his life. So that was entertaining as well too. You know, I'd say those were probably some of the big ones that stand out. I like the Edge and Finn Balor, Hell in a Cell. Because you know, Edge. Yeah, Edge came out doing a little bit of the brood stuff, man. They didn't do that really as much. I mean, I guess they kind of did. They, I think they did a different version of it. I don't know, but I love old school brood. That's how I originally remembered Edge. Yeah. That's how I first became an Edge guy. Long time ago, 97, like long time ago. So yeah,
loves edging.
I do love edging.
Wow.
Only 6 rubber bands tonight, though. They did a Hell in a Cell, and it was brutal as fuck. I mean, there's pictures out there. I mean, it looks like...
Split him to the white
like
meat,
he's
boy.
Got, like, a cow's vagina. It's, like, huge right here. And it's massive, and just... He's got staples in his head. He got fucked in that match. But it was a good match. I mean, he came out as the Demon King.
Are you watching?
I don't want to talk about it. Night one was definitely better than night two, I do feel. Yeah. I did enjoy Bianca and Asuka's match.
Man.
I love Asuka.
Dude, and Bianca's sweet, too.
Well, Bianca is just, like, she's a great champion. Like, yeah. She's a great, like, everything about her, like, very athletic. She does a lot of things great. She's great with fans. She's great with everything she does. Those two tore the house down as well, too. So I'd say those are some of my big standouts that I actually thoroughly enjoyed. And then, of course, we had...
Well, I was also bummed that Cena lost. But I get it.
I mean,
it's, you know, you pass the torch. Austin Theory. I think he has a ton of potential.
Right.
I don't think it was the time for that yet. But,
well, there
whatever.
Somebody we know was trying to force feed Austin Theory before.
You know,
so
but
I think
if Cena didn't want to do it, he wouldn't have done it, though, too. You know what I'm saying? And Cena's just, I know there was a point in time they shoved him down our throats and we couldn't stomach him. But when you look back at it, just number one, all the Make-A-Wish shit that he does.
Over 600.
And he seems like an actual genuine person from, like, everyone that you ever hear from. Mm-hmm. And the dude, he might not be the best in-ring wrestler, but he is one of the best wrestlers. He's, like, one of the last people to transcend professional wrestling. Mm-hmm. So, like, even if you don't watch professional wrestling, you knew who John Cena was.
Right.
It's like you knew who Hulk Hogan was back in the 80s, 90s.
Yep.
You don't watch wrestling, but you're like, yeah, I know who Steve Austin is. I know who The Rock is. I know who Ric Flair is. He's seen as one of those guys that transcended it. But, like, no matter whether you hated him or you loved him, everyone was always invested in what he did.
Right.
So Cena's one of those guys that I think Roman is at that. He's at that part. Roman Reigns is at that. Like, he's not yet the household name like a Cena or The Rock is, but he will be there. But, yeah speaking of which.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that brings us to the main event of the night, Roman Reigns versus Cody Rhodes.
Yep.
We talked about it last week. You kind of had your theory of what was going to happen. It was the same with a lot of people. They thought maybe it was time for Roman to take an L and get Rodeo over top and make him,
yeah,
you know, the champion and start his story or whatever they can do. And maybe it's a good time for the bloodlines to end and all this jazz. And from by all accounts, great match. Like, it was a great match. Yeah. But the ending kept left. I mean, when I say social media was in disarray,
yeah,
I mean, it was either this is fucking good, or I don't mind it, or this is shit.
This was on par, I'd say, nearly, if not. It might not have been as close. I'd say it was really damn close from what I was reading and seeing and how the internet blew up on it was when Undertaker lost the streak to Brock.
To Brock, yeah.
It was damn near that big. And I think it was just because, like, there's a lot of people that are exhausted with the bloodline and Roman Reigns, and right. I can get that to a degree.
Yep.
As somebody who came into it later because of last year, you know, at SummerSlam, I've been really into it. So, like, but then about that time, Triple H took control as well, too, and it just felt like that the story of Sammy and everything got really good, and it's been really good. So I appreciate how they've built him. And he was another one that, like, Cena years ago, they were shoving Roman down your throat, and people didn't want him as a face. And then they put him Paul Heyman and turn him into a heel and then create the bloodline. And it's one of the greatest stories in wrestling for me in a long time. I've really enjoyed it. But, yeah, Lex, for that's Lex, Chance, by the way.
That's Lex Express.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
Yeah. It's funny. But, you know, the ending just shocked everybody. I think everybody thought it was penciled in for Cody. He was with AEW, signed on after being an EVP over there. And, mm-hmm. you know, they wanted to finish the story. They built up a lot about this. Yeah. And then they kind of yanked the rug out from it. Didn't go that way. Roman ended up winning because Roman, as a heel, typically has a hard time winning on his own and has to have somebody like, I don't know, Solo Sikoa come in and do a Samoan spike on somebody's throat. Which, yeah. And Cody lost, and everybody shit 4 or 5 bricks, including myself. And instantly, I was like, "Okay, I'm not too mad about that because I'm in my head. I'm thinking, all right,
you got the Shyamalan twist. You're like, I didn't see that coming.
Exactly. That's how I looked at it initially. It was like, oh, it was a swerve. I didn't see it coming. It was something I unexpected. That didn't happen too often in wrestling,
right?
Because it was penciled in. Pretty much, we thought that Cody's gonna win.
Usually, chalk. Like, you figure it out. You're like, you know what it is. And here
we are. Yeah. So I'm like, okay, well, maybe they're gonna maybe Roman's going to keep going for 1,000 days or something like that as well, too. And then maybe they'll build Cody back up. We'll see. I'm like, well, Raw tomorrow night should be interesting. We'll see how Raw goes, right? So I'm like, I'm still in. I'm a big Cody guy. I know that's usually not. It seems like him going to WWE has been better for him because I think he does have that sports entertainment side of him as well, too.
He does more than a lot of people. And not only that, him leaving, helping create his own thing that blew up, and then coming back, he pretty much showed WWE, like, I'm a star,
right,
and became one, and then came back and got the hero's welcome. Mm-hmm. So that's how you do it.
Like, listen, I always say it, like, you've got Jericho. It started this, you know, a couple years ago during COVID, during like the Jericho cruise. He's got the Judas song that comes out. It's Fozzy song, and people started singing it on deck,
right?
And then after that, they started singing his song constantly, and that everybody sings along with it. Seth Rollins for a while has been doing his thing, and like that stuff is that when you know it's more than just being over, or doesn't matter if you're a good guy, a bad guy, when you've got a song that resonates with people, whether you're good or bad, and the entire thing's being sung with you, mm-hmm. that's a big fucking deal because not everybody gets that.
Right.
Cody Rhodes wasn't getting that in AEW, but guess what came to WWE?
Right.
People are doing it now. And it's fun to see that. You know, he's like this big, like, almost superhero, super character. So you expected the good guy to come in finally clean house on Roman, and it did not happen. And I do want to say, before I move farther, Forge, Chance.
I'm going to read this. Do you want me to read that?
Yes, please read that.
Forge says, the issue I have with it is it's so much harder to get momentum behind faces in the current era of wrestling. AEW and WWE both struggle with it. And they had it twice in a few months with Cody and Sammy, and they fed them both to Roman like dog food.
Now, I will agree that it is hard in pro wrestling, especially nowadays. I do think it's still possible with Cody because Cody cut such a great promo.
Some of those promos leading up were so good.
And that right there, to me, is pro wrestling, okay? You look at any feud from back in the day that was great, that was fantastic, and the promos and the buildup is what gets you there. It doesn't matter what they do in the ring. By the time they're already in the ring, you just want to see them wrestle. That's it. Rock Austin, Flair Dusty, Flair Steamboat, Flair Sting. It's the hype. It's Austin Michaels. Brett. It's them cutting the promos, talking shit to each other, and then finally, after people getting beat up and jumped, finally, they finally get in the ring, and both Cody and Roman were cutting great promos, and Cody was cutting just awesome promos, and he was showing that he's a main event guy. Now, I do totally agree that I think it is harder, but you kind of have to do what they did. You take them away from it for a little bit, but it's going to be really, because you got to think, what is it, 6 months you have? So you got like half a year to build him back up. That's going to be tough. It's going to be tough to build him back up and not have him shove down people's throats and act like he is just Superman. And in the meantime, who do you feed to Roman?
Right.
Because he's beat everybody. And there's not like there's anybody coming in that is large enough.
He's beat everybody.
Yeah. And Cody, I think, I do think they should have pulled the trigger. I understand why they didn't.
Right.
I get it. And it just elevates Roman even more. I don't think he needed it, but it does. And it makes him the guy. So whoever beats him now has to be special, but it's going to take a huge part on their end to do this. And I'll tell you right now, if they're smart, because fans like to sing along, not only to songs, but to catchphrases. Yeah, dummy. Yeah. If they're smart, there's a guy right there. You got LA Knight. Who has that natural charisma. He can cut a promo. He has sports entertainment ability. There's a guy right there. If you play your cards right, you get him over as the cool heel. He ends up facing Roman at some point. Maybe not taking the belt from him, but there's a guy that you can build up. You have to figure out a way to keep Cody hot. You cool him down for a little bit, and then you bring him back up. So they'll have to figure that out, how they're going to do that. I feel like Sammy is going to get lost. I think Sammy, they had a chance to pull the trigger with him, but like, you know, I think it was wrong timing. If you can keep him hot somehow, like Daniel Bryan was, I think that was kind of organic. So they're going to have a hard time. I see it. I can see it happening, but I could also see them dropping the ball, but I could also see them dropping the ball too, because they're in such a weird transition phase. Vince is now in charge.
Yeah, what's we'll Vince going to
do?
Yeah, it's like,
so what happens now? And I know a lot of people.
There's a couple, yeah, he's got out there.
Okay. I know a lot of people aren't happy that he's, you know, back in charge. So
I'm going to go back to Forge. He says, the other thing about that is Brett versus Shawn, Hogan versus Warrior, Hogan versus Rock, Austin versus Rock, etc. WrestleMania's main event used to be sacred. It was two guys, one-on-one, no bullshit, no interference, no DQs, and that's gone. The WM main event should be two guys with one clean winner.
That's the whole point of the fucking Super Bowl.
It's true, but the one Rock Austin match did, you know, and that's when it was in, I think it was in Houston, and Vince came out, and there was like the corporation came out, and they had all that stuff that was going on. So it does muddle it up. I think having those guys interfere wasn't a bad thing, but it was, if Roman's going to go over, him going over like that, like shitty heel, is good. Because if he beats Cody clean, then what do you have? So you can always go back to this. If they manage to build Cody back up, you have those two in a cage, or you have everyone's barred from ringside, or the bloodline dissolves by then, and then it's just Roman on his own. So if they're smart, though, I don't think I would wait till SummerSlam. I would have that match at SummerSlam, or before SummerSlam, and then maybe have Cody defend it all the way to SummerSlam. And if, I don't know if he's cleared yet, you put that belt on Cody now, and you bring back a heel Randy Orton, and you have,
you know how I said about it.
Yeah, you have a heel Orton, you have an Evolution thing. And that story, that history between those two, that writes itself, and that right there could be a huge main event at any show.
That's what I said, man. Like, you bring, at some point you bring, when Orton comes back, he needs to be feuding with Cody, because it needs to be, you know, Cody doing whatever and Randy Orton coming up as the Viper and being like, I was your pro, you were my protege, because you were, you know, I brought you in with Legacy, because, you know, that's
your place.
That's when Cody was first of the, and I was instantly like, I'm like, holy shit, this is Dustin's little brother. This is Dusty Rhodes as a kid, I'm, you know, I'm going to be a fan already. And he ended up running with what he was given every single time and doing the best he can. And I was also a big Orton guy. So, like, the fact that they were all in a faction together was really hype to me as well, too. So I think that would be great down the road as well, too. And I think right now that the problem is that, yes, he was super hot. You've made him super cold. Now, if we were coming out of WrestleMania and Triple H would still had full control of creative, what that'd be one thing. But what we got this week...
Well, hold on. Are you going to jump into the thing?
I am.
I want to ask you guys real quick before we get in, because that whole is a topic. How do you build Cody back up? Who does he have to go through to get him to build him up so he's ready for that matchup?
Well, he does have to go through Brock. I think he should... Their first match... If you want to stretch it out, it ends in a no contest with Brock pretty much beating the crap out of him, and then Cody having to figure out a way to beat Brock. Then he beats Brock, and then maybe Bobby Lashley. And then you feed him these guys, but you got to feed him monster heels. That way it keeps Cody hot. You can't feed him someone that's – you can't feed him like Sammy. You know what I mean? You can't feed him someone that's going to be a good babyface. Maybe have Orton come back. And he beats Orton, but he beats
Orton. He's
not
cleared it for a few months.
I don't think so, yeah. But he beats Orton like on a technicality or something like that. Or he goes through the entire bloodline in singles matches, you know. And then it ends up with Solo. And because I know they're trying to hype up Solo like the next Umaga. And they not only does it get Solo over, but that's kind of what they did already. So it's a tough call, but you kind of got to cool Cody down a little bit. You still keep him in the top section of the show, but he's not the main thing. The thing that's going to be weird, though, is how do you keep Roman fresh
when
you've already fed him everybody? And what do you do now? And like someone just said, are you
sitting on a balancing act they got to work out with Roman and Cody.
It is. And then, you know, you can't have him on TV all the time. You have to keep him sacred and rare. He has to be an attraction, because if not, after a while that ship is just you're gonna be doing the same thing over and over again. It's gonna get old, like they always did. Like they did it with Cena, they did it with The Rock, they did it with Austin. These guys become invincible and they become Superman and they're beating everybody and they defeat all the odds, and it's just like over and over, rinse repeat.
And then
after
they
a
leave
while,
to go make movies.
Yeah, but but after a while, it just become people that it's like you're constantly shoving these people down their throat, and they don't want to see you anymore.
Right.
And then they don't care if you're heel or face. They don't want to see you, and so that the gold has lost its luster after that.
Now, before we get into Raw, Forge again, because me and him have been talking, of course, all week about all this stuff. He says to build Cody back up, has to realize his mistake. He went straight for Roman. In order to beat Roman, has to fracture the bloodline, which is kind of what you're saying. Yep. So it should be more cerebral approach this time, which is a new angle, for sure. And Forge is very adamant about this. He does not think that Cody will ever be the champion. He doesn't think that. He thinks, and because of probably more than not, now what happened Monday, why he won't. Because, you know, somebody is who they are. So
let's
unless it's like in his contract. If he was smart, he would have signed.
Well,
like,
that's why
I gotta have a title run. But then that title
doesn't
run
mean you get it.
It doesn't mean he gets it. But if he could also get it and lose it like quick.
Right. True.
So get it for a second and then pull it from him.
Yeah.
So during the final matches of the second day, rumors started to swirl on social media that WWE was about to be acquired by Endeavor, the parent company of the UFC. And sure enough, the next day, on Monday morning, it is announced they are acquiring, I think it was like to the tune of like $3 billion or $31. It was something ridiculous. Like it was an absurd amount of money. I can't remember the number off the top of my head, but they made the purchase. Obviously, the UFC would be the owner of it, Endeavor would be the owner of it, but we did find out that Vince McMahon would
He got his old job back.
And so people were like, oh, what does that mean? And then Raw comes out, and people were like really excited, because usually the Raw after Mania has some pretty wild events happening. And by all accounts, it sounds like Raw, based on what I read from social media, now there's a lot of hotheads on social media, there's a lot of wrestling fans who are like, this is the worst fucking Raw I've ever seen. I was like, whoa.
Well, they were making, apparently he was making changes last minute and on the go. I guess there's a video of
Seth
in the ring, and they changed whatever he was going to do or say, because Vince was back there doing things. Whether that's true or not, I could see that happening. It sounds like
that's very Vince-like.
They confirmed that he ended up on the headset.
Yeah, he was in Gorilla again. So yeah. I think that's a mistake. Vince obviously has built an empire, and he did great. I just think he's one of those guys. Like, I think there's like anything, any type of entertainment right now. He's just one of those guys that's just out of touch.
Yeah, he's too old. And out of touch.
Well, I mean, dude, there is a point where old school is not good.
Yeah,
I mean, it really is. I mean, you hit a point where you're just like,
old school is good. Like Triple H mixes the old school with the new school. Mm-hmm. He knows how to
exactly. You're not stuck in your old ways.
Exactly, he's not stuck in the old way. And some of the stuff he was doing, no matter what you can say is entertainment. You can try to act like WWE is a TV show. It's pro wrestling at the end of the day.
Mm-hmm. Not Vince McMahon said.
Exactly. That's what they try to make it like. That's what brought you to the dance is the reason Cody and Roman was so good because it was pro wrestling. It was the Shakespeare part of pro wrestling. It was the promo. It was the drama. It was the pageantry. And then you finally got in the ring and you did an actual match. And the match doesn't have to be anything special. The hype is already there. All you got to do is you're telling the story in the ring.
Right.
That's the best thing about pro wrestling. Not all these scripts, not all these scripted promos, not all these weird shaky camera cuts and stuff like that.
God damn it.
It's
God damn it. That fucking drives me insane.
It and it's that's the thing. Like, if you can get anybody in the ring, if they know how to tell the story, they're going to capture the audience. If they know how to cut a good promo, they're going to capture the people at home, and they're going to capture the people in the seats. That's it, and it happens organically. Mm-hmm. Steve Austin, when he's cutting the Austin 316, just said, "I whooped your ass." That's organic. It's great,
yeah.
And it's real. And that's, I think, what the WWE, at least when I watched it as a fan and as a wrestler, when Vince had kind of, I don't want to say his reign of terror, but when he had that whole reign of just stuff was just so weird.
Yep.
That's what was missing for me. I was like, this is too, it's not good. And it wasn't good. It's not the performer's fault. It's just kind of what they were doing. And if he does that and makes those same mistakes again, well, he's going to be in the same boat.
Yep.
Yeah. And yeah, you knew, yeah, it felt like a light switch chance when you get to Monday night, you get to Raw. And by the time it was done, you're like, what the fuck did I just watch? and then literally, yeah, there was an hour and 5 minutes they counted down of actual wrestling in 3 hours on Monday,
dude, that was
which I love the drama. That's why I love WWE for certain parts of it is because of the story they're telling. They do a really good job of promos and all this stuff. And it was awful to fucking watch. It's one of the worst Raws I've seen in a long time because it felt like old regimen shit. It felt like Vince McMahon. Now, I will tell you, I stopped, and everybody knows this, I stopped watching WWE years ago because of the Daniel Bryan shit because I got sick of the old guard. I started watching last year at SummerSlam when Vince got in trouble for touching no-no places and left his job and had to retire or whatever, and Triple H took over. It took a few weeks, few months, and then all of a sudden, by the time you get deep into the fall time, you can feel like, man, the Bloodline stuff has gotten even better. Like, the storylines are tighter.
But you had to know he was lurking, dude.
Triple H, well, nobody really knew.
Everyone feared that.
And then January come around, he forced himself back on the board, started cleaning out, like, I'm just doing it to sell. Comes out looking like M. Bison on Monday and sells the fucking company. This stupid shave it, Vince. And nobody, you're not tricking anybody. You can tell it's been fucking dyed, by the way.
Yeah, dude, he looked fucking terrible. Stupid. He looked terrible.
Yeah, Raw Julio wore it better, so knock it off.
I think the cell's really good.
Yeah. No.
Damn it, pal. Tell him to switch the angle.
Yeah.
But Jesus Christ.
Are you guys concerned? I mean, going forward, I mean, everyone wants to know what's going to happen with Cody Rhodes. What are they going
to
do? I mean, now that Vince is back in there. Now, is Triple H completely out, or like, what happens to Triple H?
I don't know.
I'll tell you what they did. This is what Vince McMahon did. Not only did he skewer the Rhodes family, probably, but what he did Monday night once again, because he can't get over it. He also, in my opinion, skewered Triple H, having him come out at the beginning of the show, parading him around like some little ballerina, saying, "We're not changing then, now, forever," and blah, blah, blah. And then come to find out, yeah, Vince is really pulling the strings. He literally had him come out there and act like a little fucking prancing doll and did a little pony show trick, whatever you want to say, and made a complete ass of himself. He literally put him out there on blast. And I don't know if anybody's thought about it like that, but that's the way I look at it now after looking back on it. And I can tell you, I want to see more of this feud because the promos have been amazing. You got Paul Heyman involved, which, like I said last week, instantly, that's already a couple stars for me.
Right.
You've got these guys talking about personal stuff, talking about Dusty, talking about, you know, whose father cared about who more and all this, like all this great stuff. And Cody's always been actually pretty good at cutting promos. I've always liked him, even when he was with WWE the first time, you know, And now it's just fucking a pile of shit and a pile of ash. What I will tell you is, while I do care about this, I might give it one more Monday. If it ends up looking like what I saw last Monday, I'm once again done watching WWE. I said I was already done. I might wait to see what it looks like after this Monday, because if it's the same fucking shit, if Vince really is in control, because they're all trying to say, no, Triple H has got head of control. Oh, but Vince weirdly has his old position back after he properly put it in the title when he sold it or whatever he did.
Can you imagine the hubris on somebody, though, to sit there and see social media ablaze when Triple H takes
the guy is literally Dr.
Doom. He's taking his empire to new heights, making it much better, and he still has to find a way to get back in charge of creative.
Yeah, there you go.
And kind of like bump him out. It's crazy that you can't let a talent like Triple H, who are people are excited about. He goes on socials and sees the buzz. People are hyped. Mm. And then he has to go in there, and all of a sudden you got people going, this Raw sucked.
I don't know if he does watch that. I don't know if he has.
Well,
he's got to have somebody inform him.
We do know. I mean, you got to be careful with wrestling, especially in the fandom. As a Star Wars fan, trust me, the fandom in wrestling is toxic as fuck as well, too. And you got to be careful with the dirt sheets. I mean, you can't believe anything. Social media is such a fucking dumpster fire when it comes, especially to wrestling, because you're getting it week in, week out. But we do know for sure that one thing, first of all, the ratings continue to tank from Monday. The voting on those rankings, it's dropped considerably. We do know that the talent is a lot of the talent are already not happy. There's been some cryptic tweets from Asuka, cryptic tweets from Bayley.
Uh-oh.
And I'm telling you right now, first of all, let me be once again to say this, but we will be seeing old Sasha Banks, a.k.a. Monet Mercedes, will be on AEW at Forbidden Door. I guarantee it this summer. And she and Bayley are good friends. I guarantee within the year we'll see Bayley at either New Japan or somewhere else. It's going to happen. And I know that she got something cut on Monday night as well, too. The Seth Rollins thing happened. They switched. But the big thing that happened Monday that really, really pissed everybody off and really was quite the swerve, and I don't care. You can split it. You can write it. You can say it however you want. I don't give a shit that Brock turns good guy, bad guy, constantly face and heel all the time. It was nonsensical for him to come out and do what he did, and you know it's because Vince has nothing but love to jerk off Brock Lesnar. He just loves big, insane guys for whatever weird reason. And I was excited because I'm like, this is going to be a sweet main event. We're going to see Roman and Sokoa versus Cody and Brock. And shame on me for even having a hint of excitement, because there were a lot of people out there that was like, Brock's going to go heel tonight. He's going to turn on Cody because he come out being all goony. I honestly love this face run.
I thought the same thing, though. I was like, oh, Brock's probably going
to
turn on
him. Yep, and he fucking did. And we got another one of those things where Vince loves to have these Raw matches that get hyped up, those main events on Raw, and then it's just yanked out from under you. You don't even get the fucking match. So,
says it's Vince's play toy. We will like what he feeds us.
That's exactly it.
That is professional wrestling in general. Professional wrestling is just a toy box, and you could be a toy with 10 weapons, 3 heads, 16 points of articulation, whatever, and you can be the coolest toy in the toy box.
But if
no one's picking you up to play with you, then you're sitting there collecting dust. It depends. It doesn't matter what promotion it is. It just that person has to pick you up and want to play with you. That's wrestling, unfortunately.
Yeah.
There's so many great people that won't be signed. There's so many great people that will never be champion. And that's just how it is. And I know somebody's saying, you guys are speaking a foreign language. Professional wrestling is like you're doing a play. And a professional wrestler is the main actor and the stuntman at the same time. So it's up for the professional wrestler to be able to convey and gather the emotion from the crowd by telling a story in the ring as good guy, bad guy, good guy, heel, heel, whatever. But it's up to you and how you move, how you act, all the little things that people don't even pick up on that makes their brain react to you.
Certain moves that good guys,
and
bad guys.
That's what it is. So when we say stuff like Shakespeare, I'm talking about like the theatrics of pro wrestling.
There's a lot that goes into it. I don't think people really understand how much responsibility wrestlers have in the ring.
People think that don't watch pro wrestling, they think it's stupid. They think it's all fake fighting. I have had so many concussions and
beat up, and
hurt from wrestling. My body's beat up from the traveling, from getting slammed. A ring is just a steel frame with 2x12
It's not comfortable to land on.
With a, you gotta know how to land, and it still sucks. But it's just like wrestling is very intricate. When you got it, you got it, and it's fun. It's easy. It's not. It is easy when you have it, but and you gotta stay trying to be creative. You know, how do we go? I'll go out there and tell the story new. And to gather these people, or what crazy move can I do, or whatever. But that's what it is. So when we talk about like changing things on the fly and like the story, you know, what's the story we're telling tonight? Whether it's a story or on paper. And it is. It's a lot of stuff that people have no idea and they don't get it. And I guarantee, like, I always tell people, okay, well, it's dumb. We'll come train real quick.
Exactly.
And they hit the ropes, you take a bump, and they're like, no, thank you. It's like, it's not easy. Mm-hmm. It's not mm-hmm. easy to do it. Once you get the hang of it, it's fun and it's easy to, it's not easy in your body, but it's easy to, I don't want to say do, because that's not the word, because it is hard to be a wrestler, but it's, I guess, easier to be out there, I guess. It's easy to perform.
One of my favorite quotes from a movie ever is A League of Their Own, when Tom Hanks is explaining baseball.
There's no crying in baseball.
No, not even that part. There's a part where he says, you know, it's supposed to be hard. The hard is what makes it great. Yeah. If it was easy, everybody would do it.
Exactly.
But it's the hard that makes it great. And no matter what you do, if you're on TV and you're wrestling, you are doing something that I can't do and I could never do.
Right.
It's not easy to do. And it's really difficult. And there's a lot of responsibility in your hands to go out there and do your best.
And be safe.
You're
trusting someone to not drop you on your head, not punch you in the face, not break your nose. You know, when they jump out of the ring, they're trusting you to catch them or at least break their fall and not hurt each other.
Right.
There's a lot that goes into it. It's just like anything. It's just like getting out there and playing hockey. There's a lot to go. You're trusting your teammates to watch your back. If you're a quarterback, you're trusting this line here to help you not get killed. There's a lot of stuff. So, and pro wrestling, even though it's all predetermined, it's still rough, and there's a lot that goes into it that people, they don't understand. Pro wrestling is not like anything that, it's just different. It's so different. Mm-hmm. But I love it. I absolutely love it.
That's why I love this guy, man. We get that real talk, man.
Right,
And that's the stuff that I always love hearing about, man, the reality of what goes into it.
Right.
I know you watch it on WrestleMania, and you watch Raw, and that's all you know. But when you hear about what's going on behind the scenes, what goes into it, man, it's like I said, it's a whole fucking new level of respect.
And it's like, you know, Tone gets, he's very angry and mad about it, but he's passionate about it.
Right.
And he wants it. It's WWE. That's how I am with Star Wars. We've seen how great the WWE can be.
Right.
Right? So there's no reason that they can't get back there. But for whatever reason, I don't know all the behind the scenes stuff. You only know what you hear or you think you know, I guess. So, like, there's stuff that is holding it back from being great. So that's where the frustration and anger and like you can't support. The only way you can have people get the message is by hitting them in their wallet. So you don't watch it. You don't support it. You don't pay attention
when you say
to
stuff's
it.
Holding back.
We'll see after Friday. And I do want to say, last thing I do want to say, and it was really ironic that you brought up Tom Hanks, because I wanted to bring up something about Tom Hanks as well too, when you were saying something, because you've talked about League of Their Own, when you were talking about the play toys and things like that. All I could think about was him sitting in that fucking office playing with that Transformer building in Big.
Oh, Big.
He's like, I don't get it. And like, what do you don't get? He's like, well, what's so fun about playing with a building? Like, that's all I could think about. And then you brought up Tom Hanks. I'm like, this is fucking weird.
But. Well, then I was going to talk about Andy's toys in Toy Story. Like, he picked up Buzz Lightyear and wanted to play at Buzz Lightyear, but he wouldn't play with Woody.
Right.
You know what I mean? And that's how wrestling is.
So. Oh, my God. So there was three Tom Hanks in that one.
That's a lot of Tom Hanks.
That's
really we're referencing? And I'm thinking Big in my head, and then you bring up
thinking
their own.
I am thinking of toys in general, but I always say, like,
I
always say when I use that reference, I'm like, you know, we're all Andy's toys, and we're just waiting for Andy to play with us.
They're gone anyways, so don't worry about it.
Last thing I want to add, wrestling, I don't know which brother it was, but one of the Bushwhacker brothers passed away.
I can't remember which one. Yeah,
I used to love.
That's always been one of the ones you always bring up.
I used to just get a, I just love when they came on. And I mean, they were fucking awesome. I used to love the Bushwhackers.
Have you ever seen them when they were the sheep herders?
Oh, wow.
Night and day.
Really?
They were doing bloody barbed wire matches. just straight up no holds barred matches.
Man.
Brutal stuff.
Yeah. Really?
Yeah, yeah. Johnny Ace was their manager.
That's great.
Yeah.
Yeah, one of the Bushwhacker brothers, Butch passed away, so unfortunately. I think he was in his 60s. or maybe a little bit older, but they were I used to fucking
very iconic in the in that gimmick era.
They were awesome. They were fun to watch. Yeah, so no, we just want to talk a little bit about WrestleMania. If you watch WrestleMania, if you got thoughts on WrestleMania or Raw or Vince McMahon being back in creative, let us know in the comments what you think. Share your thoughts. We want to hear from you. Gentlemen, we're going to move on to trailers. We have four. So we got a lot of trailers. Sweet. We're going to power through here before we get to the big topic of the night, which is Mandalorian. Jesus Christ. But, give it a pull. It's a shit show at the table here. I'm trying to get everyone all wired in. He was almost 80. Okay, so I'm way off in age. I just wanted to feel younger.
Anakin, please. Anakin, help me, please.
There we go. All right.
Can you hear everything?
I'm so weak.
Hopefully everything sounds good. So we've got three trailers. The first one we're going to check out is one of my most anticipated Marvel properties in a while. Obviously, Secret Invasion has been something they've been alluding to. We've seen a teaser. We got our first full-on trailer for Secret Invasion. Let's check it out.
Fury. Since you've been gone, things have gotten much worse. Why do you think I came back?
You're in no shape for this fight that lies before us, old friend.
This is personal.
Very few of us know about the wars fought in the shadows that have raged on this planet. Do you feel responsible?
Where are the Avengers?
This war is one I have to fight.
Alone.
Wanted man on the planet.
You don't know what they have planned for you.
The great Nick Fury.
Yeah, Crash. Agreed.
I love a Crash. As when Tal said, since you've been gone, things have gotten much worse. He was talking about the MCU. Oh, yeah. Come on, Crash.
No, I want Crash on this, man.
Hey, you know what? I do want to get your thoughts on some stuff because we didn't get a chance to talk about Ant-Man due to some stuff bouncing around. But first of all, guys, Secret Invasion, June 21st, Disney Plus, heavy Winter Soldier vibes from this trailer. Yeah. Dark, gritty espionage, but there's a lot hanging in the balance, it would seem. I want to come to you, Rohit. First, your thoughts on what we saw from this trailer.
The trailer looks good. I'm a big fan of Samuel Jackson's Nick Fury, and I love Ben Mendelsohn as an actor. I'm at a weird point with Marvel right now. I was not a fan of Phase 4. I didn't like how they started Phase 5, and we'll get into that. So I don't really trust them. I didn't like most of their TV shows. I just felt like a lot of the most recent stuff was a lot of... It felt soulless. A lot of it felt soulless to me. So, and I think it showed because, you know, they've scaled back. They've kind of admitted it without admitting it. Mm-hmm. And that they've, in Disney, kind of
restructured. Feige's made a few comments.
But not only that, but was it Bob Chapek? No, Iger.
Iger, Bob Iger.
He's like, hey, we're scaling back. It's about, they pretty much said this, about quality over quantity.
Yes.
And I think for the longest time, we were getting a lot of stuff from Marvel and Star Wars. Well, maybe not Star. We were getting a lot of stuff from now.
I feel like MCU is far oversaturated in Star Wars.
It is. It's oversaturated, and it was oversaturated with stuff that just really wasn't good. It was okay, but it was like stuff I would never watch again. So I'm hoping this is good. I hope this is going to be a great start. So I have trust issues with them right now,
sure,
but I will definitely watch it because the trailer
was looked really good.
And the people involved, obviously the characters, yes. Nick Fury, Ben yes. Mendelsohn. I
and
mean,
the actors are all like...
Everyone's really good. This and, yeah. and the tone from it is, it seems like it's more focused, more concise.
The tone.
Tone, your thoughts on the Secret Invasion trailer?
It looks awesome. I think it's another one of those ones where, you know, again, that grittiness, because I'm a big Winter Soldier fan too. Yeah. Love Sam Jackson as Nick Fury. I think the question is, like, where in the time, like how long has he been not off on world. Earth yeah, and things yeah. like that? I think there's a lot of great questions we'll have answered, but I think the biggest fun thing about this is that this is going to kind of reset and reboot some things, I think, overall for the MCU, because you're not going to be sure who's what's who and when is the big thing about that for, like, years in the actual MCU as well too, and I think that's going to make it kind of interesting. So we'll see. And I think the next Captain America movie will be I don't know if it'll have anything necessarily to do with this. I don't think that's what you're saying, but I think that there will be some shades of that through this, and I think the armor wars, I think there's a lot of interesting things going on that might kind of play through with this specifically, because you don't know who's, like, I mean, you know, we saw already in, you know, which Spider-Man was that, you know, that Talos was actually Nick Fury, you know, and he's on S.W.O.R.D., mm-hmm. you know, up there in space. So, yeah, I mean, it looks great. It looks awesome. A lot of Nick Fury.
I think the trailer looked fucking dope. Like I said, I got major Winter Soldier vibes, and Winter Soldier is one of my favorite MCU movies.
Yeah.
I like it when they lean into the more dark, gritty espionage stuff.
Yeah.
Obviously, you know, a lot of the fantasy stuff, a lot of the cosmic stuff is interesting as well when it's done right.
Right.
But when you lean into the stuff like Winter Soldier, where it's a little bit more serious in tone, and you see more, I want to say more like street level characters.
Yeah.
Kind of getting into it, and not so yes. much superpower. That's why I think it's fucking dope. What
because
do you
it's
think
more relatable.
Yeah, definitely yeah. more relatable. Yeah. I don't have to suspend disbeliefs as much.
Right.
But it's still going to have the MCU things that we love and or just not love. But I do want to go back for a moment, because we did not get to have you on just after Ant-Man came out. We talked about Ant-Man. Tone enjoyed it a little bit more than I did. Mm-hmm. I felt like Ant-Man was just kind of a forgettable MCU experience. And I felt like, based on what it was built up to be, how it was supposed to be a major setup, not only for Kang, but just like kind of like regather itself from everything that's come out prior to this. I felt like it was just kind of a meh experience. It yeah. didn't really blow me away. It was just kind of like, okay, it's there. And as good as Jonathan Majors was, I don't feel like the Kang story, the Kang buildup was as menacing as I would like to have been. I just felt like it was just there because, hey, it's Kang, and everyone's going to be hyped to see the next big bad.
I'm with you on that. I felt the same way. I don't think it was a good showing to, if that's your big bad, and you bring him out like that, and he already loses,
mm-hmm.
and he loses in a fist fight with Ant-Man, like, regardless of powers or not, I'm just, that's not a good showing for him.
Right.
I don't know, man. MCU has not been hitting for me. I am interested in Guardians.
Mm-hmm.
I'm hoping Guardians will be good. I think just because you have the OGs doing it,
yes.
you have James Gunn, you have everybody on board, so I think that might...
That's
that
the final one. They can't fuck this up.
Hopefully not, but I think, I don't know, for me, even Phase 4, I was saying it back in Phase 4, this just it's not hitting.
Right.
And then the TV shows, a lot of it just felt just watered down Marvel, and I felt like they were on cruise control, and they couldn't be on cruise control because you just had something so great like Endgame, where you have to like start hitting out harder.
Right.
And I remember people were saying, oh, you know, it's just Phase 4. They're just building up. And for me, it built up to nothing.
Mm-hmm.
So, no, I wasn't. I was disappointed with Ant-Man. I love Paul Rudd. But there were so many things writing-wise. I just was like, it seemed a lot of contrivances. And I was very disappointed with that. I think it shows. I think one of their biggest problems, too, is the quality over quantity, like we were talking.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're trying to replace these great superheroes with other actors as if that was why we'll like them.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't like Captain America because it was Captain America. We liked it because Chris Evans did a hell of a role.
Right.
Same thing with Tony Stark. It's like, now you're just, you know.
Like the big three was like Chris Hemsworth.
Yeah, you can't replace them just by like, oh, here's Riri Williams. And
right.
That was just like, it was just, what? Like, I don't care. Like, I did not care. And it seems like
they do a lot of let's set up this show in this movie or this movie in this show instead of really paying attention to what they're doing right there, right now. Mm-hmm. So hopefully with them resetting, and I think Kevin Feige has a, he kind of has a grasp of that. I think we'll see. We'll see. I know there's going to be some stuff that's going to come out that is still that they probably have to put out.
Mm-hmm.
I do think this looks great.
Mm-hmm.
So, but yeah, I think Marvel has a chance to course correct. And I think them, and one thing I like about them compared to like Lucasfilm never admits they're wrong.
Right. Right. Yeah. They blame the fans.
It's your fault that this didn't do well. And
Feige's pretty honest, I feel, for the most
part.
Yes. He has to be careful because he's still bending the knee.
But he doesn't bullshit. He doesn't bullshit the fans.
Correct. He is. He knows, like, hey, this isn't doing well. We need to pull it back a little bit, and we need to delay some stuff to make it better.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, we know
why.
Change
his tone.
And there you go. But my biggest thing, and we'll talk about that with the Mandalorian, is like Star Wars doesn't do that. They're very the hubris in them is just like. It blows mm-hmm. my mind.
Yeah.
So we'll see, though. Like, I don't think it was a great start. Phase 4 wasn't great, in my opinion. Phase 5, the start of it, was not good. And I think it's showing. It shows that, you know. Mm-hmm. So we'll see. I think this is a great way to maybe kick off the ball or, you know, kick off the
going
the
back
path.
To an OG character.
Yes.
You're bringing it back down. You don't have the cosmic elements. I feel like a lot of Phase 5 or a lot of Phase 4 really leaned on the cosmic stuff. Like, it was kind of like, really out there.
Yeah, I think for me, like,
which I don't have an issue with, but
right,
I like the grounded stuff.
Yeah, I think you gotta have a good balance.
I think No Way Home had a good balance.
Yeah, I think if I do critique and I don't criticize the phase as much as I know you guys do, and I really do think that we need to plan a time to where we can have you on either for a normal Wednesday where we don't talk about shit we've been seeing or watching a weekend one and actually sit down and like hash out the MCU and sit here and go by detail. And it'll be probably people out there be bored as fuck unless you really care before we'd be out there.
But I think a lot of people invest as much time. They want
to
share those
you know,
thoughts
I think we need to have a really big discussion on this because, you know, I don't agree with everybody on this stuff because I think, you know, and I always relate to it. I feel like, you know, the original phases up to end game built slower and differently because that's how they had to.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas I think now, you know, because they had D+, they had the different things and it had to build differently. And because it was a lot of the cosmic stuff, it didn't always resonate great with people because it's not as relatable. So,
sure.
You know, we looked at it different. And
I guess we've been the qualities there.
Well, I think that's also part of, if you want to get technical, apparently their graphic art design has not been great, or their CGI too, which, you know, has been changed as well too. So that's what I like to hear, Jay Hill, the tone.
Jay Hill's
Marvel,
a tone
so.
On that one.
But regardless, I think this looks great. But we definitely need to plan a solid
maybe after Guardians.
I think we need to figure something
that.
Out. We need to plan something out and actually
let's
sit
do
down
it.
And
I'm
have
be,
a,
I'm down
and
I
have
love
a hash
talk.
Have a main topic. Talk about the MCU,
yep.
Hash it out, what we would do to fix it, what we think did or didn't work, you know, and we can agree to disagree on the shit or whatever
it
out, but I think it'd be a massive, awesome discussion.
I think it would be very, very good. I think it'd be very good.
Let's move on to the next trailer.
All right, 6/21, we can check out Secret Invasion. The next trailer, we're moving to DC.
Maybe Crash.
This one dropped yesterday. Let's check out the trailer for Blue Beetle.
Excuse me, Mr. Reyes. You finished scraping the gum off that lounger or what?
Everything right now feels so out of reach.
You always land on your feet, bro. You're Jaime.
They don't get out much.
I just want to rap.
Jenny?
I just want to rap.
Guard that with your life, but do not open it.
You went in to get a shops, and all you brought back was a hamburger?
Okay, I don't think it's a burger.
You haven't looked?
What the hell is that?
How did you get it to do that?
I think he likes me.
It's on your face! Get it off! Get it off!
Damn!
This ain't what you want. 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 What the?
Host acquired.
Who said that?
okay? It's gonna be okay!
Re-entry systems ready.
This ain't what you want. This ain't what you want. This ain't what you want.
What is going on?
I just want to rock.
It's called the Scarab. It's some kind of world-destroying weapon. It's designed to protect its host.
This ain't what you want.
Sometimes it does what you want, and sometimes it doesn't.
I think I cut a bus in half.
The Scarab chose you, but it belongs to me.
The love you feel for your family makes you weak.
I just wanna rap.
It won't kill my dog, stand on my money, don't lose my side.
The universe has sent you a gift, and you have to figure out what you're gonna do with it.
That's my heart. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Whatever you can imagine, I can create.
Let's party.
Ha-ha, yeah!
Nice choice.
I just wanna rap.
Whoa! It's like Batman stuff.
Batman's a fascist.
I just wanna rap.
The main, like, I don't know. I just thought that was so stupid that you would attack the most popular hero in DC.
He's but, a fascist.
Yeah. That was a joke.
Yeah, Cuddles. Yeah, I know, right? Yeah. I don't know much about a lot of DC things outside of like the mainstays.
Yeah.
This trailer looked really awesome. Looked really fun. Yeah. I'm definitely here for it. I'm pretty excited about it. Like this probably be better than Black Adam, truth be told. I don't know if anything can get much
anything
worse.
Anything is better than Black Adam. Black movie. Adam was not a good fucking movie. Yeah. It was I love The Rock.
It was better than Morbius.
When you give The Rock shitty material, The Rock ain't gonna save it, dude. Yeah, he's got gravitas and he's The Rock and he's a star.
Yeah.
But we've seen the biggest stars in the world in shitty movies with bad writing, and they can't fucking save it.
We're gonna hold on to that because everyone's like, oh, Harrison Ford's Red Hulk. Who gives a shit if it sucks?
I am telling you, man.
I don't
like
care.
Harrison Ford has got some shit movie. What was that, Hollywood Homicide?
But my
can't
point
save
is,
that shit.
Yeah, that's my point. Like you said, that The Rock's in it. Like, who cares? If it's shitty, it's shitty.
Shit is shit.
Yeah,
bad
shit
movie
is
bad. You know?
Back to this. Like, I don't know anything about Blue Beetle. I always thought it was a dorky.
I always get to mix up Booster Gold like you just did.
Yeah, exactly.
I always
do
that.
Yeah, but
I think he was the first one Doomsday beat the shit out of when he broke out of the fucking.
I think he did.
I think
yes.
Blue Beetle was the first one in the comic.
Boom. Yeah.
Sorry, Crash. I'm not gonna. I'll disrespect that all day, man. Fuck Hollywood. of all the people that would back that shit up,
it is Crash.
Crash. I don't know about your opinions, man.
I would keep that one to yourself, bro. No, I thought this trailer. I thought the trailer was good. I'm concerned about the lead because all I know him from is from Cobra Kai, and I don't know if this guy is leading man material yet. But you're there for Blue Beetle. You're not here. I would hope you're there for his character as well.
Sure.
So it's got a great cast. It's got a lot of good energy in it. I'm just concerned about. The main lead. Does he have the bravado to really have this movie?
I think he could, because I think if he's playing that goofy teen,
that does lean
look
into
like
what
he
done in Cobra Kai. Sure.
And to be honest, I don't know anything about Blue Beetle, but this looks interesting to me. And to me,
Beetle.
it reminds me, if I was just, if I didn't know anything about comic books and I saw this, I'd be like, oh, it looks like Spider-Man. So it
I
looks
was
like,
say, it
yes,
feels like
it
Miles
has,
like or something.
It has that vibe, that Spider-Man vibe. So if they can like capitalize on that, they'll have a hit on their hands. It's just going to come down to word of mouth, because no one knows who Blue Beetle is besides like comic book fans. But if people say, man, that movie was great, and then word of mouth say, you need to go see it, kind of like Dungeons and Dragons.
Exactly. Yeah.
I think that
I like what Cuddles
they'll be
said.
Good.
He gets Shang-Chi, Guardians of the Galaxy vibes from this, like an unknown, but the ceiling is high.
Yes.
I think that's
yeah.
the way
And
to
James
look at
Gunn
it.
Needs to not comment, because I think he does more damage to these movies.
Yeah.
He's reminding us, well, this isn't going to be a mine. It's like, dude, shut up, because then no one's going to go see it.
Right,
like, just
right.
Stop,
the people that are fans of Blue Beetle have so far that I know of, that I, because I reached reached out in the B&B Lounge on Facebook, which if you're not a member, you're welcome to join and talk with us all day.
Yeah.
The fans of the character are excited. They said that
that's awesome.
There's a lot of tropes or whatever, a lot of things in here that...
Don't tell me what to do, El Blanco.
Blanco says, go watch Young Justice and you'll get Blue Beetle. Don't tell him what to do.
Yeah, Blanco.
He tells you what to do.
Why don't you bring us some cookies?
You know, Blanco, you go watch Young Justice.
Yeah.
You'll get Blue Beetle.
You'll get Booster Gold. I mean Blue Beetle.
We use this.
Oh, man, I will book you.
Oh, man.
Please don't pay me.
he's gonna book you, and you're going to show up, and he's just going to be laying there in, like, tighty whities and, like, have a...
Well, you honestly get paid the most for that, so there you go.
I want to go back with the Crash says. I don't know much about
his Patreon,
but I will be there to see this big W for the Latino community. I agree with
that.
I mean, they are going to nail the vibe, much like we saw with Ms. Marvel. You got George Lopez, who when I saw the trailer first, I was like, that guy looks like George Lopez, but that's not George Lopez.
We're
you
both
guys
like,
no, it is George Lopez. Yeah. I was like, oh, shit, okay.
Looking like, was it Damon Manju? Was that guy's... the wizard from Shazam.
Oh Jesus! Yeah, yeah.
No, if it channels those Ms. Marvel vibes, Cuddles, I think this could be a really, really.
That's
good
what movie. I said too. I said if it leans in like how Ms. Marvel was, I think this could definitely.
That's actually the vibes that I got from this. Yeah. You know, just kind of somebody who just stumbles upon these powers and is trying to and trying to find their place in the world, but also embrace
a lot of
the
family support.
Yes, so some major Ms. Marvel vibes.
I hope it's successful, just for that actor alone,
and because I like the color blue,
and I just I do like the color blue, and just you know a good Latino superhero, that'd be awesome.
Yeah, DC needs a fucking win.
Yeah, and I don't hate DC. It's another thing, you know, the stuff like that gets shit on. It's like, oh, you're just hating. No, again, it goes down to I know what you're capable of.
Yep.
So stop giving a shit.
Right.
Because we know what you're capable of. So and this looks cool. So I hope it does well.
It's very cool.
DC's animated stuff, which I recently got back on. Holy shit. Yeah, that stuff is...
Animated stuff is where it's at.
Dude, their animated stuff, their Flashpoint, unreal.
That's the one to go to?
Yeah, one of them.
What else do you like?
I watched Red Sun,
yeah,
which was very interesting.
That's
watching Hush
tale.
Now. There's a few Batman ones I watched. Oh, my God. Dark Knight Returns was great. I love that, how they did that. I didn't like Killing Joke. I was bummed. I did not like
that. He's not the only one. No. You know what? He's not the only one that said that. I've seen a couple people say that.
I remember
that
seeing that in the theater, and I was very disappointed.
Man, I really liked
it. Yeah. Of course.
Crash it. Shazam 2 was dead on arrival. I haven't heard anyone talk about Shazam 2.
I actually want to see it.
You know who
I
heard talk about
Shazam
2? The actor. And he keeps blaming everybody. Like, dude, stop.
He needs to stop.
Just stop
doing that shit right away.
See you later.
And Under the Red Hood was really good. Yep. Yeah, he needs to stop, man.
All right, we're going to take a break from comic books. We're going to hop over to Netflix, a movie that came out during the pandemic on Netflix, Extraction, with Chris Hemsworth. We liked the movie. It was entertaining, a little bit shallow, but entertaining nonetheless.
Yeah, sometimes that works, though.
This trailer is actually pretty dope, especially the ending. Over-the-top action. Let's check out the trailer for Extraction 2.
Mario comes out.
Hey. Move.
Why?
Chris Evans on that train.
Dude, that was
Chris
sweet.
Evans on a fucking train with a minigun takes down a helicopter. Wow. I am there for this.
Yeah, so I'll fight my way into the self-checkout at Walmart.
Cuddle says, that is how I fight my way into the self-checkout at Walmart.
That was cool.
That was dope, man. He hits the Molotov with the shield, his arms on fire. He's fighting with his arm on fire.
That's a neat little thing to kind of think about.
Sometimes stuff like that, it just works. Like, you're like, oh, it's very shallow, but like,
but it's just, it's built for the small screen.
Yeah,
it's
yeah,
it's a good small screen experience.
That's why like the first John Wick was so good.
Yeah,
and I mean all of them, but like, it's just simple, just action.
It's like 80s action movies.
It is.
It's just, you're just riding the action from plot point to plot point, and you're there for the excitement.
Did you watch Plane? Was it Plane? Is that what it's called?
Bro. No, I heard it was great,
bro.
I'm telling you right now. When that trailer came out, him and I agree. We were like, this looks fucking terrible.
Yeah.
This
and
is
going
to be Gerard Butler's ending. This has to be the nail in the coffin. Ends up being one of the best action movies I've seen in a while.
I got
to
watch
that. Total homage to like 90s action.
Yeah.
Really? I got
to
watch that.
It's
like,
clutch.
It's weird.
And that's the vibe that I get from Extraction. It's just, you're just there for the plot, point to point action. Mm-hmm. Here's a little bit of plot. Here's a little bit of
saving the president's daughter in a prison.
Yeah.
Yeah, like Olympus Has Fallen type stuff.
Yeah. And it's just like, I dig that, man. So I think this looks entertaining. It's June 21st on Netflix.
Cool.
And we liked the first one. We thought it was entertaining. Tony is finishing up his first. I'm on the fifth. That's how things are rolling tonight. We have one final trailer.
I was so sorry.
This is the one final trailer.
The R goes on the right ear.
Okay, I got it. Are we good? Yeah. We're good?
Guys, action. Obviously, one of the most anticipated movies of the year, Spider-Man Across Spider-Verse.
Oh, I think
about Barbie. Sequel to one of the best animated movies I've seen in the last 20, 30, 40 years.
Yeah, hands down, one of the best comic movies ever.
Amazing movie. Let's check out the trailer for Spider-Man Across Spider-Verse.
My name is Miles Morales. I'm Brooklyn's one and only Spider-Man. And things are going great.
Oh, yeah. You were supposed to be here at 5.
All right, whatever.
Whatever?
Wow.
Whatever?
So are you like a cow or a Dalmatian?
I am the Spot.
That's not funny. Don't do that.
Miles' grades are pretty good. A in AP Physics.
That's my little man.
And a B in Spanish.
What?
Ooh, okay.
Miles.
Are you trying to
Mira, that's what I'm saying.
I gotta go. All right, bye.
He's lying to you. And I think you know it.
What's up, danger?
Miles!
Wanna get out of here?
Oh! When? So wait a minute. There's an elite crew with all the best spider people in it?
Who's the new guy?
This is unbelievable.
This is the lobby.
Miguel O'Hara.
The whole thing was his idea.
What's a guy got to do to join this spider team?
You can never be part of this.
Don't even get me started on Doctor Strange and the little nerd back on Earth 1999-99.
Come on, go easy on the kid. He had a terrible teacher.
Peter.
Miles.
Mayday. You have a baby?
I have a baby.
No puedo más, no puedo más. I'll take it from here.
Miles, being Spider-Man is a sacrifice.
You have a choice between saving one person and saving every world.
Send me home.
I can't do that.
I can do both! Spider-Man always...
Not always.
What about Uncle Ben?
If not for Uncle Ben, most of us wouldn't be here.
Can't stop me now!
You can't run forever, kid!
I can't lose one more friend.
Miguel, this isn't what we talked about!
You knew?
You have no idea what you're doing!
Everyone keeps telling me how my story is supposed to go.
Nah.
I'm gonna do my own thing.
All stations, stop Spider-Man!
You know me?
I looked at my uncle and...
Let me guess. He died?
I looked at my uncle and... Well, let me guess. He died.
And they do the meme bit.
It's all of them. I think, man, like, I was like, how are you going to top that first one.
That's a hard one to follow, man.
Shit, they might do it.
That was a hype trailer.
Yeah, I'm excited for this.
Your thoughts, man. I mean, what'd you think, dude?
Goosebumps. I got goosebumps right now.
You play the awesome track. What's up, Danger?
Yes, and I just, it's
slow.
It's just, I love how, I don't know, man. I love it. I love it. Like, I just think it reminds me, gives me the feels of the first one.
Yep.
And this one just looks so interesting, and I can't wait. I honestly can't wait.
It's so hard to follow up an amazing movie,
right?
And match it. You know, it's possible, but you know, it's something like this. I felt like, you know, when the first one came out, I was like, this is like lightning in a bottle. I'm like, this is just such a rare thing to have happen with an animated film. Just have such an impactful story. It had the amazing art style. I mean, a lot of people just fucking loved it. And, you know, and it's one of those movies, at first I was like, I don't know if we need a follow-up to it. It's a good standalone thing, but here we are, we're getting a sequel, and it looks fucking dope. Like, it looks really good. Tone, what stood out to you other than Scarlet Spider? Yeah, it's a little tight down there.
No, he was knocking on the table.
I love that Spider-Man 2099. Spider-Man 2099 is the centerpiece. That was always one of the underrated Spider-Mans.
Part one of two, yes.
And, you know.
Wait, what? Really?
Saw Scarlet Spider. That was great. And then we saw him again. I only saw him once, but I love it. Just the first one was such a great surprise in every way. And we've wanted more since, and we're getting more, and it looks so good. And
the animation is just so unrivaled.
Everything about it, and it fucking works. And listen, Spider-Man is one of my all-time favorite fucking comic book superheroes. So more Spider-Men, women, all of them. Like I'm ready for more of it. Stoked, super stoked.
Yeah. I love how they reach into that. How you grab all the different variations of Spider-Man. I feel like that's something that's so cool. But I can confirm that Spider-Man Noir will not be in this. Nick Cage gave an interview and said you'll have to talk to Sony about that. I am not.
What?
And I don't believe he's going to be a part of the Spider-Man Noir show. There is a show that is in the works.
Oh, I wonder if they don't want to pay him the money.
It's possible, but I mean, I can also see Nick Cage being the type of guy that says, I'm a one and done with a great role. You know, I can see he's a different actor than what he was back in the day.
This is true.
But I mean, at the same time, I'm sure he could command quite a bit of money. I loved his interview recently where he's like, somebody asked him, like, why, you know, you're not in the MCU yet. You know, we're waiting for you to get into the MCU. And he's like, I mean, he goes, I like the MCU, but he's like, I don't have to be in the MCU. I'm Nick fucking Cage. Yeah. And you're just like, you know what?
He's
man
fucking right.
Makes a good point. He does not need the MCU.
And I'm sure he'd want to be Ghost Rider anyways.
He's like, I'm done with
you. That's actually probably why he might not want to do it again. It's because of that. So,
pay Cage money. It would cost him $25 in a 4x4. Come on. Come on. Nick, he's busy doing Renfield, man. He ain't got time for MCU shit. But no, dope-ass trailer. Awesome soundtrack. Trailer. I mean, I'm just excited for this. June 2nd, 2023.
Man, movies.
I'm telling you, dude.
Love it. Movies are
piling
back.
Piling up with movies between now and fucking Christmas. Every weekend. I mean, Tony, man, when Tom Cruise put out Top Gun, everyone's like, you know what? Time to get back in the movie.
Yep.
And like literally every week we have Brian just got back from seeing the Mario movie.
How was it?
Brian, we got to hear your quick thoughts, man. Mario movie, yay, nay? I know the critic reviews and the audience reviews are vastly different.
I trust audience reviews over critics.
I do to an extent. Sometimes I feel like audience reviews are like user reviews on Metacritic. It's just really hard to take some of them serious.
True. I'm not going in there expecting, like...
Not expecting an Oscar-winning movie, right. But I mean, I expect it to hit all the right notes.
Crash, you're going to have to extrapolate on that one in the Discord, because I might have to visit math teacher.
3 out of 5? Okay.
Zach says 3 for 5 out of the Mario movie.
That's
my math
bad.
Professor showed us a data chart that shows a correlation between movies Nick Cage is in and people drowned in swimming. Wow. That is a your what professor, a, your math
wow.
professor is fucking wild. What
better be a Nick
are?
Cage
is
fan.
He Nick Cage? He's like this. Then
Brian says 3 for 5 for Mario. 3 for 5.
Wow. Okay, 3 for 5. That's cool. Right. That's
now,
cool.
What if you're like a kid?
Yeah, that's the thing. I'm going to see it on Sunday
right?
with the boys.
That's
I mean, I want to see the movie.
Taking my kid
Mario,
tomorrow, so
I know my oldest is a huge Mario fan. He loves playing all the games, so. He's really excited to see it. 5 for 5 for a child.
Okay. 5 for 5 for the kids. All right.
Kids will have fun. I'm going to get bored. Cool. Can't wait.
Yeah.
Just get some bocce sticks or some pretzels.
I will definitely get out. I just get a big bucket of popcorn and veg out, man. That's the best way to do it. So,
what's up, Danger?
All right, guys. What's we up, are Danger? Here. The final topic of the night, and I feel like this is where the beefiest conversation is going to be. We don't want to run super late, but look, The Mandalorian is one of the tentpole titles on Disney Plus from the Star Wars universe.
Supposed to be the tentpole title, actually.
Supposed to be.
We're six episodes into an 8-episode season. A little bit further along in the mid-season chat, but that's what we're going to do. We're going to talk about Mandalorian because I feel like there is some concerns out there and based on social media. I know I have my opinions of the show so far. I know these guys have some very passionate thoughts as well. I'm just going to say, like, I thought the first two episodes were really, really good. It continued what I appreciated with the Mandalorian series.
Right.
From there, though, it really feels like a scatterbrained experience. I feel like I'm getting a lot of self-contained stories that don't have anything to do with the overarching themes that were built in the first two episodes. And we talked about it earlier today. I do think this is the best-looking show on Disney Plus.
Yeah, it looks great.
For most of the episodes. Over the last couple of episodes, though, I feel like they've really leaned into the campy nature of things, and some of it's been a little bit more cringy, especially some of the action sequences. Some of the things have just been it's just felt a little off. But the last episode, I feel like, was one of the better episodes because, obviously, Bryce Dallas Howard's at the helm as director. I do feel like she is really good as a director. Now, we can debate the material that she's given to work with and the story that she has to tell. She can only do so much when the writer's like, hey, look, here's what we want for the story. Mm-hmm. Here's where we need to take it, make it happen. And I do feel like she does a little bit better job than what we saw from Carl Weathers. I know he did an episode.
She certainly cares more about practical effects than some of the other people.
She really does. She really does. But yeah, I feel like there was a couple of episodes where some of the CGI just was like, I'm not saying it's as bad as what we got in Boba Fett with the chase scene through the city, but some of it was like, okay, I'm not too sure about some of this. But more or less, the focus of the story really seems to be all over the place right now.
Yeah.
We even got a Mandalorian episode where we did a Boba Fett and just said, hey, Mando, have a seat. We're doing something else. We're focusing on another storyline completely, which was, again, one of those bizarre decisions that they make with these Star Wars shows. But, Rohit, I want to come to you first, man. We're obviously, again, six episodes in to the third season of Mandalorian. What's your overall take on the series so far?
For me, I came to watch The Mandalorian for Din and Grogu because no matter what anyone says, it is their show. All the marketing is made to, you know, the toys, the marketing, Lego sets.
He's in the logo.
He was in the logo. He's not anymore. They switched it, but it's his show, and this season has not been his show. The fandom, especially after today's episode, is split again, unfortunately. And nobody has a problem with Bo. That's not the issue. The issue is it's not her show.
Right.
Yes, it's called The Mandalorian, but like I said, all the marketing, all the toys, all the stuff, Greef Karga calls him Mando. It's his show, supposed to be. It has not been his show. He has been a side character this season more than anything. I don't think before I got here, I was listening to some stuff. There's a lot of backstage like hustle and bustle that could be true. Kathleen Kennedy sticking her nose in the business, trying to say this is what she wants. Pedro Pascal obviously not being on set. You probably won't see him unmasked this season because there was a big issue in season two that got blown off like it was just a bunch of bullshit. But apparently, it's coming back up. People think there was a big blow off, so you won't see him unmasked. So now they're putting the focus on Bo.
Which we heard all these whispers a couple years ago or a year and a half ago or whatever it was.
Yes.
That there was some behind the scenes. Because I remember hearing some scuffles with Kathleen Kennedy and with the guys involved. And then we heard stuff about Pedro crying about having the helmet on, which guess what, buddy? You signed up for it. So I don't know what to tell you on that one. But
I guess it's weird, though, too, because when you do have like Katie Sackhoff, she doesn't have the helmet on a lot of times. It's like on, you know, here and there. I don't know. For me, the episodes are good. They're not bad. I like the action scenes. The dogfights have been great. Yeah. I feel like this episode or this season does a bad job of I want to elevate this character, so I make these other characters dumb or make like the New Republic is stupid. Like you deserve to lose but they're supposed to be heroes. And I think a lot of it, and I don't know if it's people meddling in, but a lot of it seems like, okay, all of our shows now, we're going to try to fix plot holes that happened in the sequel trilogy, or we're going to try to build up to the sequel trilogy to make these things make sense. When at first it had nothing to do with the sequel trilogy, it was its own
prequel.
No, the sequels. The sequels, okay. Like the Rey and all that stuff, like the cloning and all that. Even Bad Batch.
Oh, okay.
There's a lot of stuff about cloning and stuff like that, and it's just like, don't. Whether you like the sequels or you didn't like the sequels, it didn't do well for your fan base. It divided your fan base. Don't go to something that left a bad taste in like 60% of your fans' mouths, okay? You go back to The Mandalorian, which brought everyone back together. Seasons 1 and 2, especially 2, brought everybody on board. And you had such a great ending on 2, and then you blow it in the Book of Boba Fett. And you do it in such a half-assed way. Like, oh, hey, what are you doing here? Oh, okay, come with me again. Like, that was fucking terrible. That was really, really bad. And like I said, I don't dislike this season. I am disappointed.
I think it's the
season.
Weakest of the three.
Hands down. And for me, I watch it for Din. I like Din. I like that old Western feel, that bounty hunter feel. Yeah. And he is nowhere to be found in this. He's sidelined. And the way I understand how the Darksaber was passed off, but the way they did it, they spent this whole episode, and to me, this episode felt like an SNL skit. The cameos really took me out.
Dude, that was, I want to lean on that for a second. Like, that felt so forced.
Yes. I don't mind those people, but it just was like, why?
I don't mind them either, but man, when they show up, I was just like, oh man, they're trying to take my focus off something else. They're trying to like get me to go, oh, look, here's so-and-so.
But it was
and
so
then the
goofy.
And another one, you're just like, okay.
Yeah.
Now I feel like you're really trying to draw my attention away from the bad story.
Uncle
and
Fester.
It was so goofy. And like at the end, he's like, oh, I'm sorry for what I did. And it was just
maybe.
It's just like an after school special. And we're going to knight you now. I was like, this
dude,
is not
so,
real.
Yeah,
it felt like
it wasn't good.
I was like, this is like the action was really great. The chase through the city was great. The battle droids were great.
Bryce Dallas Howard really working with very little to make it.
Yeah, but
episode.
Like the other stuff, and we spent so much time on that. And then the main plot point stuff you solve in the last 5 minutes of the show, just like, oh, this whole thing, I got to bathe in the waters of Lake Minnetonka and do all this. And you solve that in the first 2 episodes?
Yeah.
And then he does jack shit afterwards? I'm like, I'm sorry. Like, you can enjoy this season. More power to you. But you cannot sit here and tell me that it's not all over the place, that it doesn't make any fucking sense. It's just like, it's rushed. And it shouldn't be rushed because it took him 2 years to do it. And then the stuff with the Book of Boba Fett made no sense. And then in the recap, they didn't even recap that, how he got him back. Like,
man,
what
we
are we doing?
About that, man. We knew it was going to happen, too.
I'm sorry, but Lucasfilm, they say Star Wars is dead. Star Wars isn't dead, but it's not healthy.
Yeah.
And Lucasfilm and Kathleen Kennedy, they have announced like 12 projects, and 6 of them already got canceled. And the other ones, you don't even know about. And then they hyped up these sequel trilogy movies. You got Celebration this week, and they're talking about, they have a panel for the sequel trilogy villains. They sucked. I'm sorry. They were terrible. Snoke was a joke. It's just horrible. And then you bring back Palpatine. Why? It's just that whole sequel. You can enjoy that too. But it was a shit show from like not the beginning, because Force Awakens was cool. Besides the point, like it was a New Hope, you know, rehash. Right. But it was still fun.
That mix of Empire.
But everything,
and Jedi,
like all 3 movies together, it's just bad. And the fact that you had no A, B, and C, that's on you.
It almost feels like those trilogies are what we're seeing happen to Mando right now.
Yes.
Like, it's just kind of like all over the place.
It's all over the place. There's no structure. And
you mentioned the ending of this episode. I mean,
you have 2 episodes left. That's it.
It kind of alludes to what we talked about before the show, is like, are they passing the torch?
They're not passing it. They're like,
here,
we're
going
to push you in the...
Yeah, we're done with this.
If they killed him this season, I would not be surprised.
Because honestly, man, the way... I mean,
or again, if they said...
It was a weird
way
to...
If he pulls a Poochie and he's like, I have to go back to my home planet, and just disappears.
Yeah, it was a weird way to get her the saber. But it was just like, man, I feel like they're real... I mean, compared to what we were talking about, it just feels like, okay, you're about right. You're going to be ahead of Mandalore. You know where the Mythosaur is. You got the Darksaber. Congratulations. You are now... the Mandalorian going forward.
And it's almost like it was almost prophetic for that character to be like that, because you saw that through the Clone Wars and through Rebels in some ways and different things and stuff like that. But like you had said, like
her show.
They've had to backpedal so much this season on things, I think partly because somewhere with Kathleen Kennedy, clearly something with Pedro Pascal, they've had to backpedal all this stuff to get the helmet back on him. So they're having to rewrite backwards, which makes it so that the story isn't moving forward. And when you've got the season feels more like a cartoon season. And listen, I've always said that The Mandalorian has always felt like more cartoon, like live action cartoon. However, at least the first two seasons have had some form of an arc. It's all there's some form of big arc that's supposed to be going on that we think anyways, whether it's Thrawn, whether it's Gideon. We still don't know, but at least season one and two had their overall arcs. They had side quest filler episodes like a cartoon, but it always seemed to kind of like, here's a ladder a little bit, and then we'll get back on track.
You know where you're going.
This one has been nothing but like sideways moves and like has not moved the story hardly at all.
Like I said, the first two episodes I thought were a little bit more focused. Right. I was like, okay, I understand where we're going. And then we got the big hint towards, you know, Moff Gideon still being alive. And I was like, okay, cool. There's that. But then, like you said, everything else in between, you're just like, where are you fucking going with this?
Yeah, it's really weird. And like, you know, now they've gone back with Bo, and I got to say, like, some of the stuff that we were talking about that you had heard or that you were reading about, and, you know, some of the behind the scenes stuff, it starts to make sense why they might be and have been this entire season throwing Katie Sackhoff in the floor, because she's probably like, I'll wear the helmet on or off when you want me to, because, you know, her dad's a big Star Wars fan. She wants to be involved. She's been voicing the fucking character for a decade or whatever it is.
Yeah.
You know, she wants to be there. Like, listen, I love Pedro Pascal. He's fucking amazing. But, like, I know Cuddle said he's now an A-lister. I don't give a shit. He signed on for this. Like, you sign on for shit. You know, you're Carl Urban wearing Dredd's helmet the entire fucking time. There's plenty of other characters that wore helmets and have done things, and yeah, it might not be the greatest thing, but like, it's for the product that you signed up for, and now you want to be a baby back bitch about it.
Right.
Be a baby back bitch.
Do you think
get your bigger check from HBO and call it good? You know what I mean? Because honestly, yeah, he probably can say fuck it, I'm done.
But
you know,
I mean, based on looking at what they're going, the way they're going, the story. I mean, and it's not uncommon to hear Star Wars stories about changing storylines on the fly and trying to adapt.
Do it all.
I mean, we've already made the episode before. It made it sound like, oh, you can take your helmet off now. Ogro, the leader of the Mandalorian group that's on that planet, she's like, go ahead and take your helmet off. She walks
away. That was so weird.
Are they, I mean, here's my thing. Is this their attempt to be like, okay, Pedro, look, we're going to get to it. So you can, you don't have to wear a helmet.
Yes.
So she walks both lives. She can do whatever she wants. Are these like wholesale changes they're making on the fly to appease Pedro Pascal? Like, okay, look, take your fucking helmet.
I already thought they were getting towards it, because in the first two seasons, they made it seem like the Mandalorians that he was rolling with were a cult.
And he was going to roll away from him.
He was evolving as a character. Right. And every time he would take off his helmet, like even the one episode with Bill Burr, and Bill Burr's like, why do you believe in this stuff? Why do you, you know, you're doing this, you know, you're going to take off your helmet for this, but you won't take off your helmet for that. And it seemed like every time he took his helmet off, it was the character
this realization.
Evolving. Yes.
And then, you think? Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
But they literally, this season made season two null and void.
Yeah.
It ended on such a great way. Grogu was supposed to be with Luke for 2 years. Yeah. I couldn't tell. Like, it's such
I gotta wonder.
It's just,
was that the fight that Kathleen Kennedy and them had? Because I feel like Filoni and Favreau wanted to pass Grogu on. They had him for a couple seasons, got the casual fans. Listen, you can hate, I know, like, Drasen hates on Grogu, and a lot of people don't.
A little goofy, too.
I do agree with that. But what he does is he brings casuals and kids into it, so I understand the value of him. He does need to evolve, and he's very campy, and I do agree with that. But I think at that time in the season two, it was a good time to pass him on. You gave him the fucking Luke Skywalker.
And bring
him back. Let's tell that story later. We'll talk about it. Somebody said the story might be about Grogu becoming the Mandalorian. I'm also fine on that as well, too, to some degree. But
he makes a real effort to show Grogu, here's how you become a Mandalorian.
Right, which makes sense. But my question is were they trying to pass off Grogu and say, we don't need him on the show anymore?
Right.
Because he is kind of weighting this Wesley thing down.
He's supposed to be a man.
And at the same time they're trying to do that, Kathleen Kennedy goes, blah, blah, and then you got Pedro Pascal going,
honest to God, man, when she was like, you can take off your helmet to old girl, And she went out there and she was like, Bo-Katan walks. I thought Mando's going to be like, fuck, thank God. Just take his helmet off.
Yeah.
And just be like, cool, I'm going to do this shit.
Just the writing decisions. And like the first two episodes or seasons of Mando didn't have the best writing, but it was like coherent and it made
consistent,
sense.
Consistent, yeah.
It was
yeah.
consistent. Yeah. The stuff with like this season, like, oh, you can take your helmet off. Oh, you saw Mythosaur? I believe you. Like, yeah, but you're going to bathe in these living waters? Well, I need proof.
Yeah.
Oh, but you saw a Mythosaur? Fine, cool. This is the way. Take your helmet off. You walk. It's like, what are we doing?
Yeah,
like,
I don't know.
It just doesn't. It's the season is just like a mess.
My hope is that it hurts my soul
that it's a mess.
Season four will hopefully maybe they'll get back on track. Maybe Kathleen Kennedy will go fuck herself or something. I don't know.
She needs to step back and look. Dude.
Apparently she's supposed to after Indy 5, but how she hasn't lost her.
She has a hand in Indy 5.
Well, she's had a hand in all the old ones too, right?
But she's a good producer.
She is, but I feel like she gets more involved.
Well, that's just it. Most producers try to have their hands in deep into the production.
But some of them can get really obnoxious with it, and they interview with the director's vision.
Well, that's what she's doing.
Her biggest problem is, and she's done interviews on it, like the one interview she did, she's like, well, I want more women in Star Wars. I have men calling me all the time wanting to direct, but I want a woman director, this, this, and this. Look, we get it. Inclusivity is awesome. You want to represent? Awesome. That can't be your goal.
Right.
Your goal has to be your product. Because guess what happens? If you make a shitty product,
it doesn't matter who's involved.
It doesn't matter who's involved. If you make a good product, people are going to pay money. And then you can continue to make good products, and you put whoever you want in there. You just have to continue to make good products. If you don't make good products, you're not going to get the return views. You're not going to sell merchandise. You're not going to get people coming to your park. You're not going to get people caring about your product because it's shit. And as of late, it's been shit. Lindelof just left the project. They hyped this project up. He wrote this Star Wars. He left. So now they got somebody else writing. Celebrations this weekend. They're supposed to be announcing three new movies that are in the sequel trilogy era. I'm sorry, but like you can have it in that era, but once you have Rey coming back, she's a Skywalker. No, she's fucking not. There are no Skywalkers. They're dead. You killed them all. Great job. Like, that's dead. Like, there's no fixing the sequels.
If they did that, would they just be essentially retconning the other sequel?
No, it's the sequel. So it'll be after that. So if you... I'm sorry, it's too convoluted, too early, you can have sequel trilogy stuff in an era, but don't touch any of that. Let the Skywalker shit be done. You guys it's done. You ruined it. You ruined it for a lot of people.
Let the force breadcrumbs and Mandalorian be the best way to build it back up, I guess. I don't know,
but that's the thing. And stop trying to fix those plot holes. And I know people are like, yeah, but Clone Wars fixed and Rebels fixed the prequels, but the prequels didn't fuck up characters like the sequels did.
Yeah.
You can't take that. You can't fix that. You can't fix Luke Skywalker being whatever. And maybe you liked it, but there was a good chunk of people that didn't.
At least the prequel trilogy had like a going arc for it.
Yeah, the prequels had a straight path. They just the execution just wasn't there.
Right.
The sequels did not have a straight path.
Had none of it.
I felt like every sequel, they were trying to fix something from the previous movie. Like, it was just a constant retcon, no, I'm not doing this. Like, like you said, the prequels, they were bad acting here and there, poor direction
bad dialogue.
Here and there. But at least the fucking story was, like you said, a straight line. I felt like with the sequels, it was, here's one episode, and then there's, okay, well, we got to correct this from the last episode, and then set up this future, and then the final, like, we were just joking.
It was like a pissing contest between people. And the thing was, they do this, and we talked about it in the chat, the sequels did the biggest no-no of taking beloved, respected characters, dumbing them down, making them stupid, making do things that's out of their character, just to promote and build and propel your characters that haven't earned it. It's like Riri Williams, and she's Ironheart. We're supposed to like her automatically. Tony Stark earned that. Like, he earned that, okay? She hasn't. So Rey didn't earn anything, and nothing against Daisy Ridley. She got her shitty writing for
her
character.
She did the best she could with the material she was given.
They all did.
She started
all
right in Force Awakens.
You know what I mean? But, like, and I said, like, and I always go to the Rocky series, because the Rocky series has some of the best character development and just storytelling. They did not dumb down Apollo Creed just to boost up Rocky. They brought Rocky up to Apollo's level.
Right.
And in the first fight, it was a draw. And that it was really good. It was great storytelling. It was a great arc for Rocky Balboa. The Secret Trilogy did not do that. They dumbed down characters that are the bloodline of your franchise. You shit
the
on those characters, the ones that people want to see, and you put them in a shitty spot, a spot that wasn't earned. Like, if I want to see an uncle that I've loved and I haven't seen him in 40 years, and when I see him, I've been getting stories told, like, oh, yeah, your uncle's doing great, and then when I see him, he's a crackhead. That's going to be very disappointing. You understand what I'm saying? Like, that's disappointing. But you're writing these stories, so there's no reason to write that story. There's plenty of reasons, and we always go back to Cobra Kai, to respect what brought you to the dance,
yes,
but also pass the torch to that generation.
Make them an intricate part of not trying to make the new people look cool and hip and relatable because you dumbed down the fucking
yes
old people. Have them be an intricate part of moving that progression
yes
forward.
And like the sequels or hate them, they didn't do that in those movies, and that's what Mandalorian's doing here.
I do feel like they handled Han okay in the sequels.
I think Han was okay. Like, somebody
his death
there
was fine.
Yeah, it made sense. But someone need, like, Luke should have been there.
Luke
with
was the biggest. I feel
Leia.
Like that was the biggest. Like,
it was.
Like,
it was handled
yeah,
terribly.
It was
and no matter what they did with Han or Leia, what they did with Luke's
that was handled
character
terribly.
Was like, oh my god.
Yeah.
This is terrible.
But that's what. Yeah. Oh, go ahead.
Yeah. No,
but
I was just gonna say he should have lasted to the end and
to the
like
end
been
had a big babyface comeback.
Yes.
Yeah.
But that's what they're doing in like the Mandalorian. They've dumbed down Din. Jesus. And to propel other characters.
Yep.
We all know Bo's great.
Bo's an awesome character.
Awesome
I feel like
character.
They're really pushing her.
They have really pushed her. And people
seems
don't,
unnatural. Doesn't seem fluid.
Right, because the main thing is because it's not her show.
Right.
And you can say, well, it's cool, the Mandalorian. It's not her show. It is now.
Apparently.
The Book of Bo-Katan. I can't wait for season 3 of The Mandalorian to start. I wonder when that's going to start, but The Book of Bo-Katan has been pretty good so far. Mm. But unfortunately, it's like, if that backstage stuff is real,
that's bad.
It's ruining their product. And if that is real, I'm sorry. You go with the head of the snake first, or you go with the head of your corporation first. Kathleen Kennedy.
Iger's got to do something.
You have to hold her accountable.
Give her a buyout.
Who's getting held accountable at Star Wars? And then the writing this season, you got to blame Jon Favreau for that.
Yeah,
And you got to blame him for the Book of Boba Fett writing, too, unless they meddled in that. If not, that's on him.
That's what I'm starting to wonder. Was she meddling, and that's what they got didn't get along with?
That's what I'm wondering about.
What
they're saying is that she meddled in.
Producers they've been known to do that, man. I mean, obviously, they're a behind-the-scenes person. You don't hear too much about, but when a producer's involved, especially someone as experienced as Kathleen Kennedy, where she has, like, an understanding, she can get in there and be like, look, I'm a fucking producer. Here's what we're going to do. Yeah, if you look at the movies in the past, you look at troubled productions, a lot of time it's a producer overstepping, mm-hmm, getting in front of the creative people, like the director and the actor, saying, no, I want this, mm-hmm, but it doesn't fit what we're trying to do on a creative front. So when the producer starts to get overstep and get involved, your job is to provide the money.
That's what it feels like.
And do this and that. Let the directors, mm-hmm, and the writers and the actors do the thing. When the producer starts to get involved, that's when you can really fuck shit up.
Right. That's, I think that's, and one of my biggest fears, if you look at, that's what it feels like, Vince McMahon running WWE. I feel like Disney or Lucasfilm has, they're so, like, into themselves, they have such hubris that they haven't learned their lesson.
No.
And they're literally making the same mistake. So now they're trying to rush out a movie. That was a problem with the sequels. They rushed those out. Michael Arndt said, give me 3 to 5 years to create a coherent story. They said, no, we got to make that $4 billion back ASAP. You're fired. And we're going to do we're gonna have this writing table. And they didn't even know what they Rey was a Kenobi, she was a Palpatine, she was a Skywalker, she was this, she was that. They had no idea. Yeah. It kept changing. And so it's like, and now they're making that same mistake. They're trying to rush out a movie for 2025, and they're supposed to be their announcements mean nothing. Remember they had that whole board like Marvel did?
Yeah.
Half of those products, what happened to the Lando product? What happened to Rogue? Patty Jenkins, he did make a comment on that recently.
I see Donald Glover did talk about
that.
He
said it has to be the time, it has to be right. Yeah. Probably the money, too. Well, yeah. But Patty Jenkins, they filmed a whole thing about how important this was. Gone. Kevin Feige's thing, gone. But that's probably because he has to concentrate on Marvel. Ryan Johnson's thing, who knows what's going on.
Hopefully never going to happen.
Wasn't he supposed to have a whole trilogy?
But then the one that they're talking about, Taika Waititi's thing, they're pushing that. It's like, why? Stop getting, and they're star fuckers too, like whoever the most popular. The lady that directed the Miss Marvel series, they want her to direct the new movie. So it's like you're star fucking. You just want to get whoever's hot at the time to do your product. That's why they wanted Taika Waititi to do one. That's why they wanted
Dave and Dan
or the
man.
Guys, the Game of Thrones guys. Yeah. That's why they're like, oh, and we got this person. It doesn't matter. Just do something coherent. You yeah. guys are failing.
Yeah.
Like, I'm sorry. Star Wars, I get on Star Wars a lot and I nitpick because that OT trilogy was groundbreaking. Yeah. And it stood the test of time to even this day. Because it's better than run-of-the-mill. That's why I shit on Rings of Power, because it was run-of-the-mill fantasy. Star Wars is better than run-of-the-mill fantasy. And the majority of the projects as of late, the past few years, have been run-of-the-mill fantasy. And Mandalorian was a breakout.
What do you think of Andor?
Andor was really good. I just needed more action, but Andor was really good. And the writing was, like, phenomenal. The production was phenomenal. The
dialogue was really good.
The dialogue was good, and it just sucks because it didn't get a lot of love, and so now they're only doing one other season, and then it's done.
Of Andor?
Yeah.
Man, that's a lot. To be honest, though,
how
like,
long can you really drag that
right,
out?
Right, because you already know that is. You've already got the ending written in Rogue One.
It is true. It's just like.
But that's okay. Don't overstay your welcome either.
Right.
If it's really good over two seasons,
yeah,
I'm cool with
yeah,
that.
Me too.
But we honestly need to step back.
But it's Disney trying to be Disney.
As fans, and like, just because fans don't like something, I saw a lot of people saying, well, fans don't like other haters. They just don't want a woman to be.
That's a lot of faith crash after Last Jedi.
People love Bo. They love Bo-Katan, but they don't. They came to watch. The majority of people came to watch The Mandalorian.
Grogu.
Din. That's what they came to watch for. I want to see the baby. That's what they came to see.
I want to see the baby.
Yeah, and it's like, but you sideline that. This so you can't get mad at people for being upset about that because you're taking the main protagonist and you put him on the back burner.
Right.
So.
No, and you know, I'm not going to say, I would actually disagree with you, Tony. I wouldn't mind if Rian had his own trilogy because the guy has shown what happens when he is given creative freedom.
Don't let him touch anything important.
Don't let him touch anything important, but at the same time, don't let Kathleen Kennedy get involved and try to dictate where shit's going.
Yeah.
If Rian Johnson is given full control of story and direction, yes, absolutely. Looper, Glass Onion, Knives Out. The guy knows what the fuck he's doing.
Oh yeah, no, he's great on that stuff. I don't want him in Star Wars. That's what I'm saying. Like,
I don't want him in Star Wars. I wouldn't mind having him in Star Wars.
No,
but I don't want Kathleen Kennedy.
I don't want her around
his
either.
Head
but I don't want
him
involved
anymore.
He doesn't need to be involved. Like, listen, like there are things I don't mind about Last Jedi and things I conceded to you about it.
Yeah.
But at this point. He is part of the reason that the fan base has been fractured,
yeah.
And I know she probably had a hand in it as well too. But like,
she let him
I don't want
rain.
Him involved in any more Star Wars because I'm not willing to give him that chance because he could be the one that completely fucking tanks it. Looper's awesome. These movies, Knives Out, Onion, all these movies. I honestly haven't seen the movies. I know they're great. Everybody says them. I see the ratings on them. I don't want him involved in Star Wars. He doesn't need to be in Star Wars. He's done. He's good on Star Wars. We can get him out of here. Leave him. Leave him. He doesn't.
No, I feel it's fucking this.
Like no, he had his chance. He fucked it up, and he know because he had a bigger hand in that too. Because you saw the fucking interviews and the shit he was doing on Jimmy Kimmel.
That's a valid point.
We're good on that. Like he's yeah. great, but maybe he's not great with material that exists. Make up your own shit. Do some Looper stuff.
I don't think he respects it.
He claims he. Who knows? I don't fucking care. I don't want him in Star Wars. That's just the bottom line. Like. I don't dislike him. I actually will still defend his other movies because he's good at what he does. Not in Star Wars. I'm good on that. We don't need that.
Yeah. And
he's the reason it's where it's at.
If you look at Celebration this year, it's not live streaming. They Obi-Wan, that was not a good series. It looked very cheap. They really tried to inject character. They tried to, like, what was her name? Reva? Reva was a good character, but they tried to inject her. It was the wrong place, wrong time for her to be injected. And the last episode of Obi-Wan was really good. The stuff with Anakin and
Reva.
Like Reba, yeah,
Reba.
Or it was the V though, right?
Reva, it was a V,
Reva.
Whatever. Same,
but I don't know, man. Lucasfilm,
exactly.
Lucasfilm is not in a good spot, and it hasn't been in a good spot in a long time. Mm-hmm. It's had shining moments, Tales of the Jedi, the last four episodes of Clone Wars. Visions.
Bad Batch was pretty good.
Bad Batch wasn't bad. Like, this season wasn't bad. It had, like, Bad Batch goes from...
The season
I
was Mando,
be a,
season three.
Yeah, it goes...
It's been all over the
I
place.
I want to be a kid show, and then I want to be really serious. All the serious episodes were amazing. Mm-hmm. All the other stuff is just like, I'll pass on it.
They could have got away with 10
I'll say what
episodes.
I said before. I right now, at where we're standing, I think Andor is the best property they've made on Disney+.
I think I'd say that or season two of... Mando.
I mean, like, I would say, you know, the first couple seasons of Mando are really good, but I still feel like, is my mic low? Probably is. My mic's been a little goofy tonight, so. But like, no, I mean, in terms of like stuff, I do feel like Andor has just been like the quintessential.
It has been for me.
Well,
for sure.
in terms of like writing and when it does ramp up the action, it's really well
it's
done.
It's really good.
But it's the build. That's the thing I appreciate a little bit more is I didn't need a whole lot of action because the writing and the build up to that action served its purpose. It did a really good job. When it came time to ramp things up, it was like, okay, there's a lot of meaning behind it. There's a lot at stake. Mm-hmm. And that's where I feel like the strong writing is. So I feel like right now, Andor is the,
yeah,
the pinnacle when it comes to Disney Plus.
And if Kathleen Kennedy does go away, my biggest fear is that they'll just replace her with someone that's just like,
well, they're doing a trip to the moon soon.
What's up?
NASA. We're going to the moon soon. So if she wants to do a fucking trip, I got one planned out for her.
Yeah, I don't know, man. I love Star Wars so much. It was a huge part of my childhood. We used to watch the OT so many times and would always be like, man, what happens next?
After the sequel trilogy, it's been hard for me to even do that.
Honestly, it has. The sequel trilogy really, especially Last Jedi, like I don't care if you liked it. If you liked it, awesome. But that trilogy tore apart the fan base.
It fucked a lot of shit up.
And not only is...
I didn't hate it, but it fucked a lot of shit up.
But that's... Right. And I hate... I can't stand how people are nowadays. If you have legit critiques about something, you're instantly objectified. You're instantly called a hater. You're instantly insulted. Yeah, I see it on Twitter all the time. And it may be a small audience, but I see it through YouTubers. I see it, and it's disgusting. And it's on both sides. Well, this is stupid. They have this in Andor. Why is Lizzo, like, who cares? Okay, Lizzo's in it. I don't think she needed to be in it. She's not a good actress. She was pretty bad in this episode, and I do feel like I like Jack Black, but I feel like...
He was like, overactive. It was just really awkward.
And it felt like a skit. And so they really...
it felt like an SNL skit.
It did, and they took me out of the episode. So to me, it's like, what are we doing?
You know what we don't need a lot in Star Wars? Jokes and levity.
No,
we don't need a ton of it. Like
Star Wars is adventure.
It's going
fantasy.
Into MCU. Is it creeping into MCU? Where like they've too
already
much levity.
They've already tried.
Sorry about spoilers, man.
Oh,
I mean,
you're not missing much, but
you watch it. It's not like you can be like, oh wow.
Yeah, they're not like
is what it is.
They're not like mystery characters.
They'll
just
never be in another episode ever again.
Oh, they like, might, but I don't know.
I hope not.
I just don't. I love, like, I feel like how passionate Tone is about it. I just don't know what Star Wars is doing. I don't think they know what they're doing. I don't think they're learning from their mistakes. And when are they haven't been held accountable. So, like, what's going on here?
Hopefully Igar's into crack some eggs. I don't know.
And I fear what's going to get announced. The only thing I'm excited for is Ahsoka. And
I imagine they fucked that up.
I mean, Filoni is...
He's fully... Now that
Filoni's more involved than Favreau.
I don't think Favreau's involved at all. Really
no,
much
I think...
That.
And I think that's another reason why season of Mando was hurt a lot, too, because Filoni hasn't really touched it.
Well, that's my question is, again, it comes back to some of the stuff Kathleen Kennedy, and I know I'm just kind of talking in circles, but if Ahsoka comes out and does really good, let's say it does, and everybody's like, and it brings everybody back together again, right?
Right.
At what point do we stop and say he needs more power and control?
Right. Yeah.
From what I hear, they just view him as the animation guy. He I don't know if you guys know this in the chat, but Dave Filoni he helped on Avatar, the Airbender cartoon, and I don't know if you ever watched those, but that's one of the best cartoons fucking ever.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
And so he has a mind for it, and Filoni is Lucas's heir. Mm-hmm. So if anyone at least be in charge of creative, it should be him. But I think a lot of stuff at Lucasfilm, they get wrapped up in this new Hollywood wave of like politics, identity stuff. It's like, that's cool to have all that, but focus on your product and your story and focus on what brought you to the dance. And they don't do that. They're so focused on getting these agendas and these narratives out. Stop. You're just ruining something, and you have money and you're just burning it. And I honestly don't have a lot of faith in Star Wars as of late. I think the game will be good, Jedi Survivor.
Oh, that was dope.
Yeah. I had a lot of faith in this season of Mando. We only have two episodes left, and
there's only so much you can do with this.
Who's the bad guy?
I think we'll get a bad guy.
Will we?
Tease at the
we don't
end.
Even know at this point.
I honestly.
I mean, is that even enough? A tease?
I don't. I honestly.
Yeah, I, feel like this, I mean, I feel like a bad guy is what usually makes these seasons.
Yeah,
you're working up to something, right? But
the, I mean, I just these two episodes could be the best Star Wars episodes ever, but it doesn't make up for this season. And I honestly, I don't think it will.
We'll never get
and
the end.
And more power
two.
To you if you're enjoying the season. That's good. I'm not saying you can't. For me, it has honestly been a disappointment. It's been disappointment after disappointment after disappointment. With a few shining things of hope, but those few shining things of hope, that's not enough. When you're running, you paid $4 billion for a product, and you're running it into the ground. I don't know, man. Something has to be done, and it's not being done. So I don't think it ever will be done. Star
Quality
Wars
control, not Kathleen Kennedy doing it.
I mean, what if they sell Star Wars? That was a big rumor too that they're going to sell it. But
oh, really?
That was a huge
Apple was rumored.
Yeah, that was a huge rumor.
Apple's what?
That was the rumor.
Oh, boy. Okay.
But I don't know, man. I mean, that's my thoughts on it. I can't really get upset about it anymore. I do, but it's like I'm almost defeated with my when it comes to Star Wars. It's like, man, maybe I got to let go and hold on to the memories because they just keep fucking up.
Hold on for one more day, man.
You call a hotline use or what?
No, we'll see. Two more episodes. Figure out where they're going with this.
Yeah, we'll see.
It's after the Marvel episode. Can we have a Star Wars episode? Oh, man. Do a Marvel beat down, then do a Star Wars.
It'll be
beat
a lot.
Down.
Spoiler, it'll be a lot. We just
hour
heard
episode.
Yeah.
4 hours of
well,
this.
Who knows what will happen in these next two episodes of Mando? Like, I honestly feel like they could kill Din off.
Oh,
or
dude,
just,
that's. Dude, based
I would
on
not,
the way this episode ended, I'm like, he. Like his days are numbered.
It has to be.
I mean, seriously, if she has,
or
that,
they'll put him.
And she also knows what's lurking. Where does he fit into
cuddles.
This thing? In
he
terms
does
a Mandalorian.
He doesn't fit in.
He's sidekick.
He is side. He's a. That's exactly what he's been, a sidekick.
Mm-hmm. I mean, look at her flying around her ship, and he's sitting there. Oh well.
Yeah, he's doing navigation in her ship. Like, man, he's like, he's getting used to that side roll now.
Can you warm me up a hot plate back there?
Yeah,
in the micro. Give me some calf.
All right. We could go on and on and on, but that is going to do it for tonight's show.
Yeah.
Rohit, as always, my friend, a thin slice of heaven having you on, man. We appreciate
man, I appreciate
taking the time.
I love talking shop
with
you guys.
We know you're busy.
Yeah, I love
time.
Like
anytime.
Let everyone know again where you're going to be the next couple of weeks.
I will be, well, I think next week, well, if you go to my Instagram, RajuZane80, or my Twitter, at Hakeem Zane, that's HAKIM. I will be posting. I should be on AEW Dark coming up soon, tagging up with Jorah. Hopefully they'll use our promo that we cut as well. The 14th in Chicago. I'll be at Freelance Wrestling with one half of the Hustle and the Muscle, Karam. And then April 30th, I will be back in St. Louis at Glory Pro. Something I need to do too, I kind of give like a Rohit's Rants or like a thing, and I haven't been doing it, but kind of what we do on here. And I just talk about, like, hey, this is what I think about Star Wars. What do you guys think? Hey, this is what I think about Marvel. What do you guys think? And I just let you guys go in the comments. And I slacked off on it, but I need to be doing more of that. So start checking out my YouTube. But you can check my social medias because I'll be posting the videos. Won't be as cool as this stuff, but it'll just be me in front of my phone like a dork talking. If you want some merch, prowrestlingtees.com/Rohit. And then hopefully if I wrestle in the area, you guys should definitely come out and check me out while I'm in my element. Mm-hmm. And
if he ever is in the area, he's going to let us know and we
will
fucking promote that shit like crazy. We will be there for sure. Like I said, last time I saw him was in Bay City before the pandemic.
Sure.
And it was fucking
Bay City
dope
got
it
sick.
It was an amazing show. It was an amazing fight, amazing match with you and Jake.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
anytime thanks. He's local, you know we're going to promote that shit.
I appreciate it. I appreciate you guys too. And yeah, man, hopefully you guys get that spark as well, because what you guys do here is awesome. So,
and we love, really we just love nerding out, man. We love nerding out.
How can you not?
I mean,
it's fun,
dude.
It is.
There's a lot of passion involved. There's a lot of, you know.
And it wasn't me yelling this time. It was him.
I was concerned. I was like, I got to save
this love
guy.
It. I was like, yeah, get into it.
Because he was feeling, that is going to be a clip on TikTok. Trust me. I'm going to grab that fucking real quick tonight, and that'll be on TikTok for sure.
It gives you focus.
That's right.
Tone.
Yes.
Any housekeeping?
Yeah. As always, you know, we appreciate you guys for being here tonight. You know, I know it's a little bit later than norm, but you know, we appreciate you being here every week when you're able to as well. Make sure to also check out King Cuddles on Sundays for the Cuddles Wrestling Federation as well, too. We talked a lot of wrestling tonight, too. And maybe he'll sign in Rohit Raju for $5 or a coupon to McDonald's. No cheese on the cheeseburger, please. And also don't forget to check out Half-Assed Beer Review. Every week he's dropping some sweet craft beer videos. And yours truly has been featured a lot recently. We made some content a few weeks ago as well, too. That's really fun. And
then
this weekend, the Dude79, myself, and Josh from Half-Assed Beer Review are doing a little bit of a brew tour through kind of the middle belt of Michigan. We're hitting the Elma Brewing Company finally, heard about the food, see what they got untapped out there, then hitting up the one and only Maple Grill, where we get a lot of our beers from as well, too, to try their farm-to-table food and some amazing beers. And then in Saginaw, we're definitely going to end up at Oracle, maybe another food place. We'll see if we can fit it in there. So we're going to do some of that, finally do a big, big proper beer quest we haven't done in a quick minute. And then, as always, don't forget to check out Seven Dungeons, Drass and the Dungeon Master, 7 p.m. live every Monday night here on Twitch as well, to spinning that yarn and doing D&D tales. So, again, appreciate you guys. All those likes, shares, follows, retweets, whatever it might be, please also share with maybe one person that you know, cousin, whoever it is, that enjoys our content. We'd love to hear from them as well, too. Get them involved.
I do have one thing to say. There's a kid at my gym, Chris Martin. He just started, I think it's by Steamers. He started a Korean fried chicken wing stand downtown. It's called Yardbird. If you go to Instagram, it's yardbird.michigan. He's going to start back up when the weather's nice. Tell him Rohit sent you. Give him a follow. He's a really good dude, jacked out of his mind, but he's a good kid trying to get into business for himself.
Okay.
It's yardbird.michigan. Yeah, it's Korean fried chicken. It's a wing stand. Right now it's going to be Wednesday through Saturday, 5 p.m. to 12 a.m. It's over there on North Hamilton. So
Hey-o.
Make sure you give him a follow, and he's a good kid. Let him know that old Rohit sent you.
Rohit.
He's old. I don't know if you're old, Rohit.
You shall not pass. Rings of power, you have failed.
Hey, man, 37% of the fan base watched the whole series.
Yeah, it's not a good show.
That tells you something. Then the big fight.
How much did they pay for the series?
Don't mess up God of War. Don't mess up God of War. Jeff Bezos, we will be fighting.
$1 billion for 37% of the fans to finish the series.
I mean, that tells you something. And apparently this week there was a fire on set during production.
Yeah,
a pretty big fire.
Yeah.
Cool. I did comment on social media saying,
I'm sure it was super mature.
I said that fire started in a dumpster. And I got some Facebook likes.
Making friends. Basically everything Tone said. Also, if you're listening on iTunes and Spotify, make sure you hit that 5-star review. Write out a nice review if you enjoyed the show. We appreciate that support. That allows us to get more exposure. Movie magic right here on the set of B&B.
Yeah.
Catholic Kennedy, eat your heart out.
Eat my ass.
I am all about those special
eat my
effects.
Ass.
For Rohit Raju,
okay,
the Mocha-Skinned Manimal, his mother.
Calls him son because he shines like one.
Appreciate you always being on, man.
Thanks for having
appreciate
me.
You being here.
Thank you.
Fanboy Tone. I'm the Dude79. Thank you so much for watching. We'll see you next Wednesday, 9 p.m. Eastern, right here on Twitch. Have a great weekend, everybody. Stay safe.